Big 12 Football on Versus is brought to you by Hampton Hotels. At Hampton, we love having you here. And by Keystone Light. You can't always be smooth, but your beer should be.
Bill Callahan hugging his seniors as they're being introduced. Bo Rude, his father played here, his brother played here. He will get a huge round of applause. He's coming back and from an injury, and he will be able to play today. Welcome back. These two teams have split the last 10 meetings between each other. Nebraska, however, has won the last two. And as we mentioned just a couple of moments ago, Josh Freeman almost came to Nebraska. With more on that story and an update, here's Lewis Johnson.
Well, Ron, when we were out here earlier during the warm-ups, some of these Nebraska fans let Josh Freeman know that they remember that he had made the verbal commitment to come to Nebraska and then ultimately changed his mind to sign with K-State. And when I talked to Freeman during those warm-ups, I said, what happened? He said, look, it's as simple as this. I made a connection with Ron Prince, the man who is now in charge of the K-State program. I made a connection with him, decided to sign, and that's the end of the story for him. But really, the next chapter in the story as his development as a K-State quarterback continues is how this young man will handle this environment here with all these fans who remember that he wanted to come here and change his mind. Ron Prince says that the young man is still developing. He's learning a lot about game management. He trusts him to make all the throws that they need to make, and they make a lot of throws in this offense, and he ultimately believes that this young man will continue to improve. Prince says that, listen, every team in college football has flaws like we do. This is a game where you have to manage your flaws. Prince hopes to have a chance to jump on this crowd early, drop some points to try and quiet this crowd. Good luck with that, because they're still packed no matter what the record is. But despite the mistakes, despite the errors, he's hoping that the K-State offense can move forward, get this crowd quiet, play within themselves, play within the white lines, as he likes to say. And if you do that, you can beat any team on any Saturday. Ron?
Great job, Lewis. We'll be checking with you throughout the ballgame. There's 38-year-old Ron Prince, a native of Junction City, Kansas. That's where he grew up. He says, I've got a sense of what it is to be Kansas State and what the fans are hoping for and wanting. He said, don't use the term replace as far as replacing Bill Snyder, who's actually in the stands today. He said, I'm not replacing. I just want to make sure I continue what Bill Snyder has done. Let's take a look at our Under Armour advantage.
Take a look at the keys to the game today. Nebraska must find a reason to play with passion. Joe Gans alluded to that at the top. Kansas State must overcome this hostile environment. It is still that, regardless of the atmosphere in Lincoln. And then Kansas State needs to take advantage of that Nebraska rush defense. They have to prove that Nebraska has made some adjustments, found some answers. Kansas State doesn't like to run the football, Ron.
And we saw that firsthand last week, that Kansas State says that, and Ron Prince telling us that they have not run the football with authority. They want them to do that. Kansas State won the toss. They have elected to receive. This is going to be Justin McKinney, the quarterback. They fumbled the first kickoff last week. This time McKinney is stopped. He almost got ripped at the 15-yard line. Tanars is the one who made the first hit. Kansas State offense, Josh Freeman, here are some numbers on him. 4 losses, 5 touchdowns, 7 interceptions. 5 wins, 7 TDs, 3 interceptions. Rob Prince says he's still in the learning process, Kelly.
And you can tell that in the quarterback position is about decision making. And right now, Josh Freeman at times will get locked onto Jordy Nelson, and that translates to bad decisions. We'll see how that plays out this afternoon.
We'll go with a split backfield. The crowd is extremely loud. First pass of the ball game. Freeman looking. Pass complete up to the 24-yard line. Not much going on. Let's take a look at the skill position for Kansas State. Along with Jordy Nelson, you've got to keep an eye on Deion Murphy. He is number 87. He is outstanding. He has a game breaker. And on the line, Veers is going to get the start at center, but they do get some good news. Jordan Bedore, their best blocker, who has been out the last couple of weeks, last 3 weeks, he is going to be able to play today. Pick up a 5 on the play. Three wide receivers set, 2 to the right. Nebraska looks like they're going to show blitz. They back off. The run game, nothing doing. Been the Achilles heel of this Nebraska defense all year. They are 118th in defense against the rush. The defensive line, they must get pressure on Freeman. Potter and Turner are the key. Linebacker Steve Octavian leads the team in tackles. Good news, Bo Root is back. Secondary has only three interceptions. Courtney Grigsby has two of those. Third down, we'll call it five. Nebraska, six in the box. They rush four. Freeman looking deep down the sideline. Passes incomplete. Intended for Daniel Gonzalez, who we saw get hurt in last week's ballgame. Larry Asante on the coverage. Good three and out for this Nebraska defense.
And a three and out that's desperately needed by this Nebraska defense. Freeman not going to Jordy Nelson on third down. He goes outside to Gonzalez. Very good coverage by Courtney Grigsby right at the end. Actually, it was number 14, Anthony Blue, but very good coverage. Looking for the ball when the ball's in the neighborhood.
Tim Rayer, the number one punter in the Big 12, shanks it off the side of his foot. Did not give Courtney Grigsby a chance to return it. So looks like Nebraska is going to get good field position after a punt that carried just 31 yards. Well, the Nebraska offense, don't forget they hung 39 on a pretty good Kansas defense last week. Joe Gans has what teammates call a Chicago attitude, which means he doesn't back down.
Yeah, this program needs an attitude right now, and a good attitude. It's character for this young man, and that's what you're going to see the way he plays. He competes absolutely every play.
Marvin Lucky, the lone setback. And he has the football. He's had an outstanding year. Gets up over the 35-yard line to the 36, rolling on the tackle. The skill position, Marlon Lucky, as we mentioned, great year. Over 1,300 yards running the football and catching the football. He is a game breaker. And on the line, the bell cow is Brett Byford. He is on the Remington watch list. Second down, only a pickup of one on that play. We'll call it nine. Gans will go from the shotgun. Three wide receivers to the right. His first pass. Gans looking over the middle. Flush. Gets rid of it. Pass is incomplete. Off the hands of Todd Peterson. Kansas State defense, they play that 3-4. The line lost Steve Klein, the nose tackle, to injury. So Brandon Balcom is going to get the start in the center. The linebackers, Childs, Roland, Walker, and Campbell. Look for Campbell to play a little more defensive end today. And in the secondary, Justin McKinney. He's their leading tackler. Last week we saw him get a pick against Iowa State.
And with Klein, that big run-stopping nose guard out of there for Kansas State. Look for Nebraska to have some success running the ball against this 3-4 defense.
Third down and nine. Straight drop, Kansas State brings four. Under pressure, going deep. Passes tip, incomplete. Intended for Nate Swift, the junior out of Hutchinson, Minnesota.
Right place to go, but just the wrong ball to get there. Gans has to drive that ball in there. It was a deep post, but the wind's blowing a little bit. You have to take a little bit out of it in terms of getting it in the air and just drive that football to Swift. He was open.
Dan Titchener will be back to kick it away for Nebraska from his own 21-yard line. Nelson and Murphy back to receive it. They're the top return punt return team in college football. Nelson's already got a couple for TDs. Kicking with the wind, a spiraling clip kick. Fair catch is being called for by Murphy. It'll be a 36-yard punt. In the first quarter, senior day in Nebraska, we are scoreless. With a Kansas State win today, Ron Prince will be the second K-State coach to have 13 wins in his first 2 years, Gary Lohman being the other. His Wildcats, first and 10 from about the 28-yard line. Second possession of the ball game. Freeman, quick three-step drop, throws it out on the flat, incomplete. That kind of goes with the philosophy of Ron Prince offensively, which is something Mike Shanahan also has. Pass to score, run to win.
Yeah, pass is where you're going to get the big plays, and Kansas State wants to pass and pass and pass some more. Run to win means that running sets up the ways you move the chains. You have to run effectively, sometimes on first down, but you're trying to get in that third and manageable situation, and then you have to run effectively in the red zone to be a high-scoring team, and then to close out games, you also have to run.
Well, the offense of Kansas State was out of sync in the Iowa State game last week. This will be Johnson. Nothing doing. Up to the 30-yard line. We'll give him a pickup of two on the play.
And Ron, we've talked about the woes and read about the woes of Nebraska's run defense. Now, if you look at that, the statistics, you think, how in the world did we get to this point? And right now, they're just not as effective up front as they have been. Cosgrove talked to us about that yesterday. He didn't want to point anyone out, but it's a one-gap defense. You literally have one-gap responsibility up front. If you're not in the gap, a runner has room to run.
Gonzalez wide to the left, looking for Nelson over the middle. Freeman decides to keep it. He's got the first down at the 40-yard line. Great job running the football, and he's not really a good runner, but the thing about Josh Freeman, he's improved his footwork so much.
And what I like is, in the end, you see the footwork, but it's because of a good decision. He's nimble enough to make plays like that. He's a very big man. I mean, he's 6'6", 250 pounds. Think of Dante Culpepper when you see Josh Freeman. But it's not running exclusively. It's being effective when you have to do it, and he can do just that.
Now he'll try from the shotgun. As Kelly mentioned, he's a big guy. Fakes the handoff to Johnson. Still has it. Looks over the middle. Passes complete to Gonzalez into Kansas State territory. Let's take a look at this Nebraska defense under Bill Callahan. It's quite a telling story there.
Yeah, and what you need to look at is sacks and tackles for loss represent pressure. Look how the numbers were growing, and then they fall off the face of the planet right there. All of that trickles into the points allowed, and that's what Nebraska's lacking defensively, the pressure element that pressures an offense.
Pickup of 12 on that play. Pushke in motion. First and 10, three-step drop again. Deep out pattern caught inside the 40-yard line of Jordy Nelson. You know, you have heard a lot the last 2 weeks about Jordy Nelson. This man out of Riley, Kansas, just an outstanding day last week. 14 receptions, 214 yards versus Iowa State. New record for yards in a ball game. This is a young man that will do anything for this team. All-American voters, this guy is an All-American.
Yeah, there's no question about that. And the knowledge of the game is very apparent. The feel that he has when he's running his routes, finishing routes, but also reading a defense along the way.
Second down and short. This is almost a throwaway down for the Wildcat offense. Hand it off to Johnson. I don't think he got the first down. He lost the football. I think they're saying he was down. It'll be close to the first down. I think we're finally marked. It will be a first down.
Yeah, I think initially he was passed, and then the hit knocked him back past the first down marker. But this is a good sign for Nebraska's defense. Kansas State isn't real complicated offensively in their run game. They really only have one, or actually two runs, a zone running play out of that one back set. And then they'll move an H-back or a tight end back there or a fullback and run more of a power game. Really, two plays is all it amounts to.
First and 10. Ball on the 37-yard line of Nebraska. Kansas State on the move. Straight drop. Freeman hit as he throws. Caught to Nelson inside the 20 down to the 18-yard line. Freeman took a wallop, and so did Jordy Nelson from Larry Asante.
And this is exactly what Nebraska has to guard against, is letting Jordy Nelson get in the middle. Good pressure right there at the end by Kevin Dixon, number 97, but it's the great catch. But you cannot let Jordy Nelson into the middle of the field. That's where he's very, very dangerous.
Now Josh Freeman goes wide to the left. Nelson in the slot. James Johnson is back. He's playing a little quarterback. Ball is loose. Picked up by Murphy, and he saves it, but not before he's dropped at the 33-yard line. Freeman went wide to the left on there. You can see some of the Nebraska defenders now looking at each other going, is that the quarterback over there?
Yeah. Whoops, the light finally went on. But what I don't like about this play, the direct snap from Veers, the center, who has had some trouble snapping out of that shotgun snap since he's taken over for Bedore's early in the year. But then you're snapping to a running back that isn't used to catching it. I think sometimes coaches can outthink themselves in this game of football.
Second down and 25 to Nelson. Looks for a block, cuts inside. gets close to the 20, down to the 21-yard line. Morton Grigsby on the stop. They lost 15, by the way, on that previous play.
But, Ron, talk to me about that for a second. Yeah. You've been around the game a lot. Why do you outthink yourself? You're moving the ball down the field, running your offense, and then you go to this exotic play that you do not have a chance to practice very much, and it cost him that time.
Maybe you're trying to catch him off guard, but when this Kansas State offense operates well, they've got great balance in the pass game, which we've seen up to now. Third down, 15 to go. Four-man rush, Freeman plenty of time. Over the middle again to Nelson, touchdown, Kansas State.
Once again, Jordy Nelson getting into the middle of the field. And Asante, number four, is the one that's going to be covering him, but he's expecting help. As Jordy Nelson comes in right there, number four, Asante, is expecting the safety. Number 13 that's coming down to give him more help than that, and he just simply wasn't there.
You just said you cannot allow him in the middle of the field, and they did. The extra point is good. Jordy Nelson, 9 touchdowns on the year. Josh Freeman has thrown 15. Kansas State has taken the lead. Second leading receiver, 4 catches, 51 yards, and a touchdown on that drive. For the 9th time in 10 games, Kansas State scores first in a game. The only time they didn't was last week versus Iowa State. Brooks Rossman, the junior from San Diego, California, set to kick it away. Can Nebraska respond, or is this team and crowd in a little bit of a shock? This will be Grigsby. Still on his feet. Say goodbye to Courtney Grigsby. Touchdown return for Courtney Grigsby, the senior out of Omaha, Nebraska. You know, you just got this sense, Kelly, when Kansas State scored, oh my goodness, here we go again. But the first return for a touchdown on a kick since Joe Walker in 1998 got the crowd believing again. The point by Alex Henry is good. He's perfect on the year. Look at this again. It was exciting.
Courtney Grigsby, one of the seniors being honored here today. The kickoff returns are all about stopping the initial pressure, getting a seam, and then it's just speed and athletic ability running to daylight. And you talk about a senior that's being honored, and he's from Omaha, so he understands what this program at Nebraska is all about. What a great way, or a great guy, to make that big play.
Kansas State, 9th in the Big 12 as far as kickoff return yardage, and it was something that Ron Prince was concerned about last week. But this got the crowd of 84,000, another sellout, at least back on their feet, showing a little bit of hope. And there was a lot of question coming in how the crowd was going to react today, because there were signs, of course, last week and in the past few weeks. But this crowd has responded as true Nebraska classy fans always do.
Yeah, and you could see the way that they came to honor the seniors today primarily. And that's what Nebraska is all about. That tradition is what they think they're losing under this administration. But they're here to celebrate, and what a great play to do it with.
Adi Kanalik, who's having trouble on his kickoffs. This is a short kick, and Kansas State will get good field position. Close to the 40-yard line, to the 39-yard line. John McArdle is the one who came up with it, and that is something that really has concerned the coaching staff in Nebraska, because Kanalik's got an outstanding leg, but he's really struggled since last week.
You know, it's like this your golf swing, really. And I've seen your golf swing, and it's very much like your golf swing, actually. But it's the swing of the leg, and sometimes you just kind of get out of sync with that, and you miss hit. And the harder you try to hit it, the worse it gets.
And they told them, don't think about it. Just get out and swing the leg.
You cannot tell a kicker not to
That's
think
right.
about it.
Freeman looks, pass, tip, almost intercepted. Pass intended for Murphy. Tyler Wartman could have had it. Of course, Joe Gans is the quarterback of Nebraska today because Sam Keller was injured in the Texas game, and he's with our Lewis Johnson now.
Yeah, I think he's still trying to catch his breath after that touchdown. What did that do for you guys on the sideline?
Oh, my gosh. We've been talking. The team's been talking about popping one of those things forever.
Right.
And I don't know when it goes back to, 98 or something, the last time a kick return was brought. I mean, that's like popping a bottle of champagne right there. That's beautiful.
Let's get back to your shoulder. You've got the broken clavicle that's healing. How is that going?
It's healing really fast. The great thing about it, or the tough thing about the clavicle, is it hurts real bad for like the first week. And then it starts getting better, as you can see, like I'm moving around well.
Right.
And it's kind of a tease because you feel like you can be doing something. Then you'll do something and it'll shock you because it's got to mend all the way. So it's just a waiting game right now, and I'm just, you know, biding my time with, you know, lots of cardio work and things of that nature.
And your job now is to help Gans. How is he doing? How are you helping him? How much help does he need?
I was just going to say, Joe doesn't need much help. He's obviously been in the system. And I think we're finding out. We found out last week when they played Kansas. He's a tough competitor. We've always known that, but you know, he doesn't need much help from me. I just, you know, little things I see, you know, because it always helps. I always wanted him to tell me the same things. So, you know, he's doing fine. He's a great competitor, and you know, the team's responded very well to him.
All right. Well, good luck to you. Don't re-injure yourself celebrating. All
right. You're right. I got to be careful about that.
That's it. Okay, Ron, back up to you.
All right. Thank you, Lewis. I thought he was going to throw the shoulder out during that kick. Return. By the way, that was a 17-yard pickup by James Johnson just a couple of plays ago. Nothing on that, so it's second down and 10 for this Kansas State offense.
On that 17-yard run, the significant thing is we saw once again Nebraska's defense out of position. Didn't have the outside gap to the left cover.
Now the safeties drop back real deep. Pressure on Freeman. Drop back at the 49-yard line. That's only the 10th sack of the year for this Nebraska defense, a team that 2 years ago led the country in this category.
With 50 sacks. That's what they led with. And Octavian is one of those guys that have brought pretty consistent pressure. The loop inside by Dixon right there. And then Octavian comes around the back door and catches up with Freeman. But that is what the Nebraska fans want to see, and they just haven't seen it enough this year.
Octavian, 1.5 sacks this year. Third down and 14. Whistle. Penalty. Oh, I don't know about that. It was so loud. They're going to throw a flag against Nebraska. And I tell you what, that is tough. We could not hear the whistle up here. I think the officials need to talk about this one. I didn't even hear the whistle blow. I saw the flag go. Bo Rude's going to go in there and try to talk to him. Puts the helmet on, tries to get the head in there. Oh, the fans may have a little beef here. This is Gerald Wright.
False start. Offense. The penalty will be 5 yards. After the play, dead ball, personal foul. Number 97 on the offense. That'll be 15 yards from the resulting spot. Automatic first down.
Now Kevin Dixon, culprit. Let's look at it again and listen. I'll tell you what, that was pretty simultaneous there. When you're coming in and they're showing it on the big board here.
Yeah.
That's tough to hear.
And Kevin Dixon, number 97. Was called for that penalty. Remember, we just got been talking about a defensive line that needs to get after the quarterback. Those guys are lathered up on that defensive line, and they don't hear anything, I guarantee it. So, yeah, I think that was ticky-tack.
And now Kansas State will go with a couple of tight ends. Nelson moves up. Leon Patton now in the backfield. He has the ball, looking for something, finds very little. Ty Steinkuhler. Dad, of course, Dean won the Outland Trophy on the staff. Saturday, November 24th at 2 o'clock Eastern, Noon Mountain. BYU continues to make their case for the top 25 as they sit on top of the Mountain West. The Cougars hope to keep their two-year undefeated conference record alive when they host Utah versus college football. It's on. Once again, that's in 2 weeks.
Yeah, BYU, the big win against TCU last week, and all bets are off when Utah and BYU get it on between the lines.
Second down and 9. Nebraska with a lot on the line of scrimmage. Freeman running away from the pressure. Throws into the flat. Caught complete again to Jordy Nelson. His fifth reception of the afternoon. Asante on the coverage. I tell you, he doesn't have this blazing speed, but this guy, as you hit just a moment ago, he finishes his route so well.
Yeah, he's a great route finisher, and that means a lot because you can be open initially, but you have to finish the route right at the end. He kind of works back to the football a little bit. He just does a lot of the little things right. He just finds a way to get open. I played with the guy in Seattle named Steve Largent, and Nelson reminds me of him just a little bit. Maybe a little more physical talent, but the same good feel of the game.
You can only get him into politics now, that's Steve. Hooski in motion. We have another penalty flag. This time the Nebraska defense doesn't hit anybody. This will be the second
Full
motion
start.
Penalty.
65
against
offense.
K-State.
5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Logan Robinson from Agra, Kansas.
Well, the noise is causing Ron Prince's young team problems right now. And remember, they went into a hostile environment to start the season at Auburn. Mm-hmm. And they had, I think it was 17 penalties. And the majority of them were the offensive line not communicating and jumping early. We're seeing it here today.
Most penalized team in the Big 12, 117 out of 119 in college football. Johnson back in on first and 15. Pusky in motion. Here's Johnson. Going to be dragged down from behind at the 30-yard line. Good defensive effort again by Ty Steinkuhler, the junior from right here in Lincoln.
And Steinkuhler is that defensive tackle that they were counting on coming into this year. He's been banged up. And his greatest asset is, A, his hard work, and B, he's very quick off the ball. And you can see it there, the play going away. He slides down the line and makes a very, very good play for his defense.
10 rushes, 8 yards for Kansas State against a rush defense that has been horrendous this year. Two tight ends on second down and a bunch. Freeman changing the play at the line. Play clock at 2, he gets it off. Here's Johnson. Let's go to the right side. We'll try it. Freeman trying to help out with a block. He's got some room. Knocked out of bounds and drilled out of bounds at the 13-yard line. Ben Eisenhart, the senior from Culbertson, Nebraska, whose dream was to play for the Huskers, with a big-time shot. But not before he picked up 17.
And watch the backside of this defense. You have to be disciplined. See all those defensive linemen and linebackers skating by, lacking discipline to close the back door. You always have to expect that the runner could come back at any time. And that's what James Johnson does right there. And nobody is home for the black shirts of Nebraska.
Well, it's third down and short now. Little play action. Incomplete. Jordy Nelson, the intended receiver, but again, Freeman finds a spot on the turf.
Yeah, Ty Steinkuhler continuing to have a high motor and getting after Freeman. And this is what Kansas State really epitomizes their entire season. Drive the ball, look pretty efficient as you're going between the 20s, but you get bogged down and you end up kicking a field goal as opposed to getting the ball in the end zone.
Brooks Rossman, 2 of 3, kicking field goals last week versus Iowa State. They'll mark this at the 21-yard line. It'll be a 31-yard attempt on the Marcus Watts hold. And it is good. 20 of 26 on the air for the junior from San Diego, California, the transfer from Ohio University. Kansas State has regained the lead. We are still in the first. It is an absolutely perfect day for football in Lincoln, Nebraska. You can come here sometimes in November, Kelly. As you know, we could have snow on the ground, but temperatures expected to be in the 60s. The leaves have changed colors, and you're all excited because deer season is open.
Yeah, opening day of deer season. What flashbacks. I remember those days when the leaves start to change and they start to fall off the tree. It's time for Nebraska football, man. I was born and raised right in the middle of that.
Grossman's kick is going to be short. Bobby Grigsby again already has a touchdown return. Gets up to the 25. Nothing doing this time. Stay tuned for the Aflac Home versus Away Trivia Challenge and your chance to win a plasma TV and the grand prize trip to the Hula Bowl in Hawaii on January the 12th. Last week's winner, congratulations, Eric Hemseth from Des Moines, Iowa. And after having two of Iowa State's victories on versus, Lewis, you and I think we'll get the keys to the city from Gene Chisholm, I think.
Are you and Lewis? What is?
No, I said you.
Oh, okay.
No, I'll keep you.
All right.
Not a problem.
They love us in Ames, Iowa.
We're huge in Sheboygan. Roy Helu, the true freshman from Danville, California, now in the backfield. Coaches were bragging about him yesterday. Danzo drops back, goes over the middle, deep. Pop Purify. Maurice Purify with his 41st catch of the year. Joe Gann says this guy's got banana fingers. They're huge.
And at 6'4", 220 with gigantic hands, you throw the ball up and you let him engulf it just like that. Even with tight coverage, if Gann throws the right ball and that big body of Purify shields the defender, it's like a vacuum cleaner, and you have great confidence in that as a quarterback.
You know, and one of the things on Maurice Purify is he catches the ball in traffic. He's not afraid. We saw it there. First and 10 for the Huskers. Wildcat territory. Gans looks to put it up. Rush gets away. Still on his feet. He can make plays. And he's able to pick up about 7 on the play before Justin Rowan, the senior from Ponca City, Oklahoma, comes up with his second stop.
And the difference between Joe Gans and Sam Keller is this right here. Joe doesn't have the arm that Sam does, but Joe can do stuff like this, avoids the rush and then makes plays with his feet. Coming out of Illinois, he was a dual threat quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see it in that play right there. They're not going to expose him in the run game a whole lot with design quarterback runs because they have to keep him healthy because Sam Keller is over there nursing a collarbone at this point in time.
And Kansas State's going to whistle for a timeout with 3:18 left to play in the first. Nebraska facing 2nd and 3. Maurice Purify last week, 7 receptions, 158 yards, his best day ever, 3 touchdowns. Watch this catch, though, Kelly. This is NFL. One-handed it.
Yeah, a lot of times you see wide receivers practicing that in practice, but he has gigantic hands. Look at that. The size of the hand, the size of the fingers, and Joe Gans told us yesterday it's banana fingers. They're gigantic. But a receiver, you have to have big, strong hands, ideally. Mm-hmm. But you also have to have soft hands, and Purify seems to have the whole package.
There's offensive coordinator Sean Watson to his left right there in your picture. He is an outstanding offensive coordinator. He could not say enough about Maurice Purify because he's overcome his brother being shot this year and his girlfriend dying. And Sean Watson says this young man's having a very special season considering the tragedies he's had. 2nd down and 3 for the Huskers. Helu still in the backfield, and he will get the carry. Leans forward, and he'll get the first down. Nice job by the true freshman who's elevated his game. They've got a couple of good true freshmen behind Marlon Lucky. Quinton Castile, who is just kind of like Jaworski Lane down at Texas A&M. Cody Glenn has become kind of the odd man out here in the I-back spot.
Yeah, Castile is a big running back at 245, but he also has 4 or 5 speed coming out of high school. And Roy Helu, we saw in that play, he's a big guy as well. They have a lot of running backs, but the young guys have to learn to pass protect. That's why they're not getting a lot of playing time at this point.
About Purify with a little halfback pass. He's looking. No place to go, being traced from behind, but he still makes something out of it. Marcus Watts was chasing him from the backside. Purify just did a great job of not losing the football.
Yeah, Purify, obviously the receiver on the end around, looking to throw this ball deep on a one receiver route down the field, but when you have the ball in your hand, you have to make good decisions. The receiver wasn't open down the field. It was Jared Stunn, so Purify does the next best thing and makes a play with his feet.
Pickup of 7 on the play, second and short for the Huskers. Right at the 30-yard line. Elu straight ahead, close to the first down. Depends on where they mark it. Let's take a look at the TomTom 2 travel log. About a 2-hour drive from Kansas State here. And the last time Kansas State made the trip to Lincoln back in 05, Nebraska won it 27-25 in 91 meetings. Nebraska leads the overall series 74-15. And there's the real TomTom. Tom Osborne, now the interim athletic director. And we get the sense, too, as they have the measurement here. And having been around this program a lot of years, talking to the people in the program, they said, you know, when Coach Osborne took over, there was a sense of relief. It's almost a relaxation. But we still got the sense, talking to people yesterday, Kelly, and you can disagree with me, there's still a lot of tenseness here in Lincoln, Nebraska, especially in the athletic department. People are still wondering what is going on.
Oh, yeah. And I
even though Tom Osborne has relieved a lot of the fears.
We had a chance to sit down at least for a moment or two with Coach Callahan yesterday. And, yeah, tension is exactly the way I would describe what I saw and experienced, and rightly so. You know, the people here in Nebraska aren't used to what's going on. They haven't seen it before, really, in our lifetime. And Coach Osborne is that calming influence. And now it's what decisions does Coach Osborne make to get this ship headed in the right direction.
Coach Callahan refused to answer any questions about the current situation. Quinton Castile now in the backfield. He's got it. Puts the big head down, and he gets down close to the first down. I think he may have got it by just a little itty bit. Ray Cheatham coming up from the stop. But Coach Callahan's agent, by the name of Gary O'Hagan from IMG International Marketing Group, he didn't help anything in today's Omaha World Herald. Tom Chattel wrote a great column. Here's what his agent said. If they don't want him to be the coach, they can fire him. Then fire him. That's what his agent was saying. And he said, the main quote, though, was, listen to how stupid you people are. You people need to start studying soil content or something. Why don't you find out how many pair of socks get washed every day in the locker room? Doesn't help the situation at all. Handoff to Lucky. So his agent really kind of threw a lot of fuel on this fire. He said that program the media is contributing is self-devouring. You know how when flesh starts eating flesh? That's what's happening down there. Now, we don't know if he was speaking for Coach Callahan, and you pray that he wasn't.
Well, I believe in the reality of what representation means, and if an agent is representing me, I'm certainly going to make sure he knows where I'm coming from and what my mind is on the thing. So Coach Callahan will have an opportunity to correct that if that isn't his feelings.
We're not even sure if Coach Callahan saw the paper on that. Yes, looks left, throws right, gets it to Lucky. He's got some running room. Inside the 20, touchdown, Nebraska. Yards on the touchdown by Marlon Lucky, his 9th TD of the year.
Ron, let me give you a little insight to the way coaches think in this game. Remember that play from Iowa State?
Mm-hmm.
We saw it about 3 or 4 times last week. A very productive play that we hadn't seen out of Iowa State prior to that. Nebraska says, you know what? It worked last week. Let's try it on our field. And guess what? The same result.
Alex Henry for the extra point. He's been perfect this whole year, and he remains there. Nice job of Dan selling it, though.
Yeah, and what you want to do with an athletic, speedy defense that Kansas State is known for is use their speed against them, the misdirection, fake to the left, and come back and throw the screen to the right with the running back that tends to get lost after the play-action fake. And then Lucky has the skill to make a little and take it into the end zone. Very well disguised, well executed. And Kansas State didn't make the corrections from last week very well.
Marlon Lucky, one of the most versatile performers for this Nebraska team, came in with 61 receptions, most by a running back in college football. used to wear number 20. Of course, that was the great Johnny Rogers.
Yeah, and Marlon Lucky just said, you know, it's nothing against Johnny Rogers. I basically haven't lived up to the number, and I want to kind of go my own way and do my own thing, make my own name, so to speak, and he's doing it. A very good all-around player. He's grown into that position. In the West Coast offense, the running back has to be a very effective receiver, a very good pass protector, let alone be effective when you carry the football.
And Alec will try it again. His last kickoff wasn't very good. The man that was born in war-torn Bosnia, now out of Fort Worth, Texas, said the first time he saw football, he said it was stupid. He said everybody played soccer, spent some time in Germany, and
I think if you play soccer, I don't think I'd be called anything stupid.
Well, Kelly's email address for you soccer coaches are. Well, he'll try it again. This is more like it. Nothing doing. 15-yard line. Let's check in with Lewis Johnson.
All right. Well, right now on the Nebraska sideline here, we've got Courtney Grigsby, who electrified this big red crowd earlier with that kickoff return for a touchdown. He's been getting some attention to his left ankle. They've taken off the shoe. They retaped him. He's got a noticeable limp. Grigsby does, and we'll have to see if he can get back on the field and be effective. He's trying to give that nod like, I'm okay, but right now he's got a serious limp. We'll see what happens as the game develops, guys.
All right, Lewis, good job on that. Kansas State finds themselves first and 10 from about their own 16-yard line. Trailing 14-10, final 26 seconds of the opening quarter. Penalty flag, let's stop everything. That'll be the third motion penalty against Kansas
State. False start. 63 offense. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
And if there was any wondering about how Nebraska's fans, Cornhusker Nation, was going to respond today, you see it in those three penalties. It is incredibly hard to hear down on the field. And that young offensive line, and really a young offense overall, is having a hard time in Kansas State.
Kansas State team setting school records for completed passes this year. And Nebraska looks like they may be coming. Only rush four, a little delayed draw right up the middle. Johnson gets the first down as he nears the 30-yard line. With 19 seconds left in the quarter, Brian Wilson, Bo Rude combining to make the stop.
Cosgrove told me yesterday, second long or even first and long, screen or draw, and my team understands that. They understood it, but they just didn't play the defense very well that time, and they got gashed by that draw.
8 rushes, 49 yards for Johnson. That's going to be it the first quarter. Both teams already heading out. Clock ticks inside of 10 seconds. It's been a great opening quarter. Kansas State struck first, but then Nebraska electrified the crowd with Courtney Grigsby's 94-yard kickoff return. The stands are full. It's senior day in Nebraska. Quarter number 2, straight ahead. Tom Osborne won back-to-back national titles, 94-95, won his third in 97, had an 84% winning percentage here at Nebraska, now the interim athletic director. And as we mentioned, and we can't stress this enough, a calming force. Is this another penalty? It is. This will be the fourth penalty against this Kansas State offense. They
False
average
start,
8 a game.
78 offense, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Alisena Alisena. He is the culprit. Ron Prince wants to know about it.
Alisena this time and Robinson the time before. It isn't like it's just one guy, but you have to wait for the center, Veers, to snap the football and then move.
4 false starts, and Freeman now rolling out looking for Jordy Nelson. Instead, he gets it to Deion Murphy. He'll get close to the 39-yard line. We'll mark it at about the 29. It'll be a pickup of 6. Anthony Blue, the freshman out of Cedar Hill, Texas, just outside of Dallas, on the stop. This Deion Murphy went to Coffeyville Community College, an outstanding player. He's an aspiring actor. He says he patterns his game after Dante Hall, and his dad actually coached Dante Hall in high school.
Who does he pattern his acting after?
I haven't seen him act yet.
But he's that big play guy. He's the speed guy, and a lot of the special plays revolve around him.
On second and nine, by the left side of that Nebraska defense, not a whole lot going on. Steve Octavian, the senior out of Naples, Florida, already with six tackles in the ballgame, including a sack. Kansas State, you can see through the first quarter, Freeman, 7-11, 96 yards. That second drive was just outstanding. Johnson has rushed nearly to 50 yards, but Jordy Nelson, five catches, already with a touchdown.
And, you know, relatively speaking, Kansas State's been pretty balanced most of the year. They want to throw the ball, run effectively, but the same thing that's happened here today has happened all year. Ineffective in the red zone.
Third down and six. Here comes the blitz. Freeman reads it, pass dropped. They're going to call it incomplete. Yes. Steve Octavian with the hit on James Johnson. Great stop again by this black shirt defense of Nebraska.
A very good job by Cosgrove calling pressure when he needs pressure. They get it that time. Just when the offensive lineman stepped inside, an opening right to the quarterback opened up, and Octavian finished the play at the other end.
Ball is loose from the 18-yard line. Jones looking, has some room, sidesteps one more. Still on his feet, looks for another block, finally hit from behind as he gets inside the 40. Andre Jones, the senior out of Fort Walton Beach, Florida. His longest return prior to that was 24 yards.
You know what's odd?
47, that was 43-yard return, Kelly.
What's odd about this, Ron, is a lot of times a muff ball like that kind of works in your favor because it sets up the blocking more. A lot of good returns happen because of patience. When you drop the ball, you have to be patient. Jones picks it up and makes a nice play just as the return was being set up.
Well, one of the raps on this Nebraska offense is they haven't come out fast in the opening quarter. In fact, only one time they scored more than 7 points in the opening stanza, and that was Kansas last week. By the way, that's a season-long punt return for the Huskers.
And a new wrinkle with no running backs in the backfield behind the quarterback.
Jones going down the middle, has a man, touchdown, Nebraska! His first touchdown reception of the year, it covered 36 yards.
And Ron, it wasn't very good defensive recognition from Kansas State. I pointed out the empty backfield. It meant one more fast wide receiver out, and Hardy was one of them, and they just totally dropped coverage down the middle of the field.
And I think you have to also give some kudos to Joe Gans on that, because he not only had a little mustard on it, it was right on the money. Alex Henry will try the extra point again. Ball's down, kick up and away, and it's good.
Nebraska doesn't do a lot of empty backfield, but Gans knows what to look for and take advantage of it. Hardy is open because of the lack of recognition. Throw the right ball to the open guy. Big play, Nebraska. And Gans knows that his team needs a lot of those this afternoon.
When the coaches talked about France Hardy, they say this young man's got home run potential. He gets his first touchdown reception of the year, only his fifth of his career. And that has given Nebraska a 21-10 lead here in quarter number two. And as we were during the break, we were looking at the sidelines, and you can see the return yards there favoring Nebraska. But one thing we saw that they haven't seen on the sideline of Nebraska in 5 weeks, a lot of smiles and high-fiving. Long time to go. There's still a lot of football left. But it's like these guys get the sense that we're feeling it today. This may be the day.
Yeah, and a win cures a lot of things. And that's what we're seeing right now to Nebraska. Playing well, having some good things happen. They're having fun playing this afternoon.
This will be Justin McKinney. He already has one in his career. Kickoff return for a touchdown. This time he's going to be corralled as Nebraska doing a nice job back at the 28-yard line. Ricky Tenarsa on the stop. Well, as we talked about, the Nebraska team definitely needs a victory, and Joe Gann says they want to be the team that continues the Nebraska tradition.
It'll be awesome. You know, I mean, that's exactly what this team needs. We need a win. You know, we need to get that taste out of our mouth. We lost five in a row, and we care about this program more than anybody, and it's just really tough on us to go through this losing streak, especially with the tradition here. You know, we know what fans expect, and they should expect that because we've won for so long here. And, you know, we don't want to be that team that, you know, brings everything down. We want to be the team that, you know, carries on this great tradition.
This time over the middle, incomplete. And just picking up on that, you know, there's so much written and talked about, not only in Nebraska, but nationally. Whose fault is this because of the five? They point to the coaching staff, the coordinators, the players. It doesn't really matter because these young men that are playing for Nebraska, they bleed Nebraska red. They care about this program, and they're hurting. And that's the bottom line here. And you can point fingers at this man or anybody you want, but these kids are playing hard. Second down and 10 for Kansas State, trailing 21-10 here in quarter number two. Very loud again. Three-step drop by Freeman into the flat. Complete. Not a whole lot going on for Jaron Mastrud, the big sophomore from Beaverton, Oregon. That team may lose a couple on that play.
And Nebraska just doing a nice job in a lot of the areas they haven't been doing consistently well throughout the year. Run defense, they're in their one gap responsibilities. They're tackling at a much more effective level than they have consistently throughout the year as well. And their coverage has been pretty good.
Third down and 9. Kansas State, 2 of 5 this afternoon. Fumbled snap. Freeman has some problems. Look out. Dumps it off. Incomplete to Johnson. I think they're going to say it's an incomplete pass, but Kevin Dixon, who has been a menace the whole day to Josh Freeman, again in the Kansas State backfield.
Well, Kevin Dixon has been getting a lot of time throughout the year because Ty Steinkuhler has been banged up just a little bit, so Dixon has been in there, and Dixon's motor has been running the moment the ball was kicked off this afternoon.
Rayer this time kicking with the win. He gets a boomer. This will go back to about the 17-yard line. Penalty flies coming in every which way. And it's going to come back. Dixon, by the way, 3 quarterback pressures today. 56-yard punt, by the way, by Rayer. 11 on the return, but a lot of it's going to come back.
Yeah, Nebraska will start deep. Backed up this time, and this will be the first time Gans has had to control this offense today in a backed up situation.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Number 7 on the return team. The penalty administered half the distance of the goal. First down.
Nebraska, a pretty clean team as far as penalties. Only about 6 a ball game. We've got a timeout. 12:07 in the second. Nebraska leads it 21-10. Just about 3 minutes gone by here in quarter number 2. Nebraska leading it 21-10 over the Kansas State Wildcats, along with Lewis Johnson, Kelly Stoffer, Amron Thulin. Backed up on their own 10-yard line. Yes, no play action. This little slip to Lucky. Gets some running room, lowers the shoulder as he gets up to the 20, to the 22-yard line, a pickup of 12. This Nebraska defense has been playing well as of late. Bo Rude doing a great job, and his brother standing by now with Lewis Johnson.
Yeah, I have Bear Rude down here, and I imagine any offensive player that's run across this field since the 70s has probably had a Rude awakening. What's it like to come back Tampa Bay with the bye week? You're here watching everybody play.
You know, I saw at the start of the year on the schedule it was going to work out. I mean, it's awesome because, I mean, it would have been the one game I would have picked to come back for, too. So to see his last game here is real special.
Tell me about your family, particularly your father, who first had the sack record here. What's it been like to follow them, follow the Nebraska programs, and come in, and you end up becoming the sack leader?
You know, it's awesome. It's something I grew up going all these games, and, you know, it's kind of spoiled because you don't realize how special this is until you leave, and not everybody's got it. So I love it. You know, I love coming back to these games, and, you know, we're very proud of all this stuff here.
And a tough season, so what's it like to watch it from afar, not be able to get on the field and make a difference?
Yeah, I mean, it's tough, you know, but, you know, all you can do is support them. You know, one thing I hated when I was playing was just, you know, criticizing from far away. You know, I just try to support them because, you know, I know the effort's there. I know they're trying. So And all you do is support them. And like right now, they're playing well. I'm loving it.
All right. Well, enjoy the game. And who knows, another route maybe to come in a few weeks, a few years.
I'm away from that.
All right. Okay. Right.
Well, Lewis will be appearing at the Cornhusker Hotel through next Friday. And you can see on this graphic the all-time leading tacklers, Barrett Rood, 432 tackles.
Wow.
His brother, by the way, Bo Rood, just passed their father, Dad, Tom. Tom was also a captain, just like Barrett and Bo. So it's the Nebraska Red is definitely part of the Rood family. And Bo Rood, his mother tragically passed away, a heart attack 16 years ago, and they had an incredible relationship, and says he dedicates everything he does to his mother.
Yeah, 16 months ago, actually.
16 months ago.
It's still raw in their heart, but they're playing on, and they gather here in memory of her, actually.
Third down and eight. Purify trying to reach back and make the one-handed catch again. But we've got a penalty flag back behind the line of scrimmage, back at the 16-yard line. Purify's kind of mad. He thought he should have had that.
Roughing the passer. Number 96 defense, 15 yards previous spot, first down.
Moses Manu. That is the fifth penalty against Kansas State today.
We talked with Ron Prince about those penalties last week prior to the Iowa State game, and he said they really have it corrected. A lot of them were the miscommunications early in the year, but he didn't think they were a highly penalized team since then. But stuff like that will drive Ron Prince absolutely mad.
Nate Swift in the slot on the left side. Lone setback. 10-10 to play in the second. 21-10. Nebraska leading. Gans looks right. Quickly scans left. Has a man. First down and a little extra to spare. Inside the 45 to the 43-yard line is Terrence Nunn. That is his first catch of the afternoon.
And this is what Joe Gans' knowledge of this offense does. He starts to the right, quickly goes back to the left. That's how it has to happen. And you have to get to your second and third receivers in that progression quickly, or you don't get the ball off. Excellent job by Joe Gans.
And a big game. First and 10. Ball's on the 43 of Kansas State. Gans has some time. Looks, just dumps it off short. Nice little shake and bake move down to the 32-yard line is Quinton Castile. Only his second reception of the year for the true freshman from LaPorte, Texas.
A little shake and bake. This is a double ankle breaker right here. Joe Gans coming underneath the soft cover two coverage by Kansas State. Exactly where he should have gone with it. But whoops, right here. Justin McKinney, I believe, was the beneficiary of that move. Wow. That's a freshman, Ron.
That's a freshman that weighs 245 pounds. He picks up 11 on the play. Now Marlon Lucky back in the I-back spot. It'll be Phillips in motion. They look for Lucky. The little slip. He's still being able to make stuff out of nothing. Keeps running. Still on his feet. Down to the 12-yard line. Receptions, yards in the season and career.
And this is what Nebraska fans have grown to love, is the second effort by their running backs and actually all their players. But Marlon Lucky has been doing that all year. He's been solid from the beginning up to this point. They're starting to get a whole lot more out of him, especially in that receiving department.
Three receptions, 58 yards for Lucky. You can see the red zone offense for Nebraska this year. First and 10 for the Huskers. And I think the play clock may have run down. It is. It will be delay of game.
Delay of game.
Boy, that hurts.
Offense, 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Nebraska 8 for their last 8 in the red zone. You see scores in the bottom of your screen. We'll keep you posted on what's going on. Clemson on top of Wake, Penn State over Temple. Bill Callahan looking on, trying to break his squad's 5-game losing skid and not lose to Kansas State in Kansas, which if they do that, it'll be the first time in 40 years that K-State and KU have been able to beat the Huskers in the same year. First down and 15, closing in on 8 minutes to play here in quarter number 2. Looking, throwing it up to purified. Touchdown, Nebraska. Penalty flag is down, however.
I believe this is going to be offensive pass interference.
It might be.
Purify put his hands on the back of the defender and pushed him right by.
Pass interference. Offense. Number 16. Penalties 15 yards. Previous spot. Replay first down.
And I believe Purify was matched up on Justin McKinney. And Purify, the big receiver at 6'4". McKinney's only 5'9", but you can't do that right there. When you push off to gain an advantage, it's always going to be called on the offense. Right there, it was good up to that point, but instead of pushing the defender by, Purify just has to go straight up and get that football. That was a nice call by that official in the corner of the end zone.
Well, we heard Joe Gans talking about Purify and then just how an advantage he has, especially on the fade route. We saw it there. So instead of a touchdown, it's first down and 30. Ball's on the 32-yard line. They just keep backing up. Now problems fixed. Picked up a couple on that play. That'll bring up second down and 28 for the Huskers. 7:40 to play. And surveys the defense. Straight drops, got some time. Wobbly pass, complete down to the 10-yard line. Todd Peterson on the reception, the junior from Grand Island, Nebraska. The former walk-on doing a nice job of pulling that in.
Sean Watson told us yesterday, Gans is a timing thrower. This is a great example of it. If that ball doesn't come out in time, that very, very narrow window closes. Todd Peterson in that seam, that bracketed defense by Kansas State, and that ball needs to be there exactly at the right time.
Well, it was first down and 30. Now it's third down and 8. Lucky to his left. They bunch up the right side. Gans looking, throwing into the end zone. Pass is tipped. Nice job, Justin McKinney. Had the pick versus Iowa State last week. Got a little hold on it this time.
McKinney does a nice job. He's actually a defender out in the flat. In a sense, doesn't have anyone to cover, and so he's reading the quarterback, and he jumps back inside on that football. Very good heads-up play by McKinney.
Alex Henry will attempt the field goal. Perfect on the year, 7 for 7. Jake Wesch, the holder. He threw a touchdown pass on a fake last year against Kansas State. This time they put it down, up and away. And it is good. 27-yard field goal by Alex Henry, 8th of the year, and the Huskers add to their lead. Joe Gans, 9 for 12, 173 yards, 2 touchdown passes this afternoon. That's why the Huskers lead 24-10, 6:39 left in the half.
Not a bad start, huh?
No, I think, and you know, we were talking during the break, you get the sense, and Ron Chris telling us earlier this week, they got outplayed offense, defense, and special teams last week in the loss to Iowa State, but they didn't play with a lot of emotion, and it seems like they've fallen into that right now.
Yeah, the emotion is all on the other side of the field in Nebraska. Nebraska's playing with that passion that Joe Gans talked about at the beginning of this game.
Adi Kanalik. This will be McKinney. Looking for some room. This time hops over a couple of tacklers, gets up to the 30-yard line. That's where Kansas State will begin. Here is the Aflac home versus away trivia challenge. Text 1, 2, or 3 to 83777787 for your chance to win a plasma TV and the grand prize trip, of course, to the Hula Bowl in Hawaii, which is January the 12th. 11-year history of the Big 12. How many North Division titles have the Wildcats and Huskers combined to win? Text 1, 2, or 3, 6, 7, or 8. And you can do that right now. All right, Kansas State takes over. First and 10 on their own 30-yard line. Freeman seeing some pressure, throws, pass complete. Up to the 45-yard line. Jordy Nelson on the reception. Six catches already this afternoon. For an update on Josh Freeman, here's Lewis Johnson. Lewis.
Well, you know, I've been watching him run on the sideline, and Freeman has been pretty methodical going over and talking on the phone, kind of slapping his players' hands. Don't see much of an emotional exchange from him as he tries to lead the team. But before the game, we were talking about what happened last week at Iowa State and how they jumped out early, Iowa State did, on K-State. He said, that's the kind of thing that can't happen here today. It's already happened. Get the momentum in the second half and try and catch up. That's not what they want, but they're almost there again as we get closer to the half.
Well, you got that right. Deion Murphy looking for some running room. Nice job by the black shirt defense. Kevin Dixon, who is having an outstanding day. Three quarterback pressures and a tackle. Now, they might dream of scholarships and Super Bowls, but right now the only thing that matters is crushing their archenemy. Get inside the most heated high school rivalries in the country. A Versus original series brought to you by NFL Films. Greatest high school football rivalries. Thursday, 8 o'clock, only on Versus.
And Ron, you just mentioned Kevin Dixon. Right now, Logan Robinson, the left guard, number 65 for Kansas State, absolutely is having no success at blocking Kevin Dixon.
Freeman looking under pressure, hit as he throws, overthrown. Pass looking for Deion Murphy, but the pressure that this Nebraska defense, this time by Ndamukong Suh, has just done enough to kind of rattle Josh Freeman just a little bit.
And this has been lacking in this black shirt defense this entire season. They had 9 sacks coming into today. The tackles for loss were way down. You can tell that right now they have a different feel about them.
Mm-hmm. Third down and long for Kansas State. 84,000 plus are standing. 19 for the first down.
Jordy Nelson is right there. This is where Josh Freeman likes to look.
Looks left, little slip screen off the hands of James Johnson, incomplete. Kansas State forced to kick it away again.
And third and long, that's really kind of a maintenance play, a draw or a screen, but Kansas State is out of sync, and right now they can't even execute the screen.
You know, and that's what Ron Prince was talking about. He talked about managing the game as the snap was fumbled just a little bit on third down for Josh Freeman. Nay Swift, he'll down it right at the 27-yard line, trying to tell him that you don't have to get all of it on third down, just get about half it. Nebraska with the football and the lead in the second.
Delivered so far, zero late fees. Netflix.
.546 left to play in quarter number two. Along with Kelly Stoffer, Lewis Johnson, I'm Rod Thulin. Nebraska leading Kansas State 24-10. Kansas State struck first. Nebraska has rebounded every time. They've got first and 10 from their own 27-yard line. Castile Thomas Lawson now will form the I formation. Well, purified to get off the field. Too many guys. Almost a substitution penalty there.
Very easily could have been, but I'm thinking now two tight ends, two running backs, two wide receivers, your lineman and quarterback, that doesn't add up.
No, it looks like Frank Solich, Tom Osborne days. Castile straight ahead running. Just bowling over people. Quentin Castile, they tell him to get out his truck stick. That's a term when you're playing, I guess, a video game and you want to run somebody over, you get to the truck stick. So they keep yelling, Castile, use your truck stick on guys.
And Joe Gans in Nebraska thought that they could run the ball on this team. And the double bubble, this is the bubble. One's right here and one's on the other side. The guard is uncovered. Nebraska thinks they can run their zone scheme against that look and be very successful. And that's a good example of it on that last play.
Steele's got a little bit of speed, and he's going to stay in there in the I formation again with a couple of tight ends again.
Right in this softness right there.
Steele, this time he goes to the left side, puts the head down, crosses the 45 down to the 44-yard line. Pickup of 8 on the play. We'll set up a second down and 2. Boy, I tell you, he is a true freshman. And the one thing that freshmen sometimes have trouble doing is securing the football. That's what Sean Watson and everybody telling him. Young man, secure the football.
Yeah. Secure the football is number 1. Be patient when you're running the football is 2. And the third thing is pass protection. And the young men are starting to pass protect better, so they're getting more reps. They hang on to the football. That talent is going to show up on the field.
Second and short, and they're still going to go with that tandem. In the backfield behind Joe Gans. Third straight carry. Castile got the first down. Inside the 40, down to the 39-yard line, a pickup of 5. Brandon Balkum, subbing for Steve Klein at that nose tackle spot on the stop.
Remember that Coach Callahan is not opposed to running 10, 12, 15 plays in a row. So right now, up front, Nebraska's getting lathered up a little bit. They're finding that bubble. If you're at home, look for that bubble. The place the guard is not covered, Nebraska wants to run to that softness. In fact, Gans wants to check to that softness a lot of times.
They started going to this two-back set during the Texas game. They said they like it. About 4 in a row. The steal just puts the head down to the 35-yard line. Pickup of 4. I guess they're going to run him till he drops.
Well, that was an example of that truck stick right there.
Yeah.
You push the button on the football video game and you can juke people or run right over the top, and Castile can do both. Yards after contact. What does a running back do when nothing's there?
Mm-hmm.
And that's a good indication of how good a running back is, how effective. And Castile is doing a nice job on this drive.
Well, Nebraska is going to call a timeout as Quentin Castile will get a little breather. So the freshman, 4 straight carries. You know, it is senior day, but we got a lot of special people here. We already talked to Bo Rood, and just a couple moments ago, one of the greats in Nebraska baseball history, Jabba Chamberlain, now pitching for the New York Yankees, also being honored. Nebraska, an outstanding baseball program here. They play in one of the nicest fields, and just a couple of minutes ago, Jabba Chamberlain got honored. He's got a little Yankee and Nebraska cap on. 84,000 went crazy when they saw him and they played the video on the screen. And he gets the hugs from the family members. How about that? 2-0, a save. Forget about those numbers. The guy throws about 150 miles an hour.
They didn't get a whole lot off him, that's for sure.
No, now with Andy Pettit maybe not coming back, he may be the 5th starter this year for the Yankees. A little baseball trivia there. On second down, Lucky, running room, inside the 30 to the 25, another Nebraska first down. Pickup of 9 on the play. 72 yards rushing now for the Huskers in this ballgame.
Joe Gans and Marlon Lucky run at the bubble, and you can see the cutback right there to the softness. The guard's uncovered. He has an opportunity to help initially in a double team and then get to that next level of linebackers, creating that softness. Now, where Nebraska has to watch out is right here. They've been driving the football. Kansas State wants to do something to come up with a negative play.
Andy Sand, the fullback, they give it to Lucky, who follows his block. Down to the 20-yard line, bounces out, down to about the 16-yard line. Pickup of 9. That's just flat-out tough running by not only Lucky, but Castile.
Yeah, it's just a matter of want-to with Marlon Lucky and his guys up front. And Nix and Hickman and Byford and Sluin and Burks, they're all getting their blocks. They're getting up to that second level. And then right now, Marlon Lucky is not being denied.
Following behind Byford, the big center from Hartselle, Alabama, who says, I can't wait to go home and get a little cooked squirrel and dumplings from my grandma.
Well, I think that might pass on that.
I don't want to follow behind anybody that eats cooked squirrel.
Better than
second, second down and short. Lucky straight ahead down to the 5.
Take a look at the fit up front. You have a hat on a hat, and then Nebraska is moving the line of scrimmage into the secondary of Kansas State, and Marlon Lucky is running with an attitude.
And that brings up first down and goal from the 5-yard line. 2:16 to play in the second quarter. Lucky again looks for running room, looking for the pylon. Does he reach? Does he get it? Touchdown, Nebraska!
Nebraska right now is saying, you know, we don't believe that Kansas State can touch us. Put a hat on the hat, and on the edge is J.B. Phillips, number 85, working overtime. You just cover the defense, you continue to work hard, and then you have a running back that just is simply making it happen here today. That's a good formula for Nebraska football.
Just tough running by these Huskers.
Wow, the people right now in Husker Nation is saying, where has this been?
I know. And it's here today. And the extra point is perfect again. Henry is perfect on the year. Marlon Lucky with the touchdown. Let's take a look at Lowe's building towards the BCS, and we can see how the Big 12 stacks up. The only team with four in the top 15 of any conference. Kansas, perfect 9-0. Tough game in Stillwater today against Oklahoma State. The Sooners, the Missouri Tigers, and of course Texas, Texas Tech meeting this afternoon. All four ranked in the top 15 of the BCS. That's pretty good.
You get into that argument, what's the best football conference in the nation? And the SEC has an argument as well, but I think that graphic right there pretty much tells the story, wouldn't you think, Ron?
I think it does, too. I mean, you know, you can talk and people argue about tough schedules, this, that, whatever. But come on, throw the Big 12 in there. Eight plays, 73 yards, just over 340 for Marlon Lucky. Every play was a run. That is amazing. Castile had 38 of those yards. Lucky had four carries for 35 yards.
And what that is called is an attitude drive.
Yeah. 98 yards rushing now for this Nebraska team against a defense that only gives up about 126 yards rushing. Yep, ball just blew off as the sun comes back out here in Lincoln, Nebraska.
And Lucky has to be getting close to 1,000 yards on the season. He only has 39 here today.
Man.
He's going over 900 right now. If he continues on this pace before the afternoon's out, he might surpass that mark.
I think the way they've seen success running the football on that last drive, my goodness, you might want to keep with it.
You know, and Callahan has had drives during the year where he's not opposed to running it a dozen times in a row because his offensive line starts to feel it up front.
Still 2:05 to play, and you're kicking off against a very dangerous Kansas State return team. McKinney loses it, and he's going to take a knee, wisely so. Coming up at halftime, we'll take a look at the Nissan Heisman Watch. You'll want to see who Kelly has number one. Plus, we hand out our Big 12 awards. Highlights and stats all coming up on the Nissan Halftime Report just in a couple of minutes.
You know, what's interesting, Ron, is even on the kickoff return that did not come out of the end zone, the fans in the stadium continued to cheer as Nebraska ran down to cover that kick. Every player on that kickoff coverage team went to the ball carrier.
Mm-hmm.
That's the effort that these fans have come to expect.
Nebraska tried for their 39th consecutive winning record at home, and they need the victory today to reach that goal. Final 2 minutes, Freeman has to dump it. Not even turning around is Leon Patton. That was ugly.
And Zach Potter made sure that Josh Freeman did not have any more time to let that route develop. Pressure out of Nebraska's front four, and once in a while an extra rusher from the linebacking position has been a nightmare for Kansas State in this first half.
You can see the total yards, plus 120, 118 for Nebraska. Second down and 10, even 2 minutes to play here in the second. Freeman looks left, looks over the middle. Nelson's got him incomplete instead. Had it in his hand, but he was sandwiched in between a couple of black shirts, including Bo Rude. You know, Anthony West also in on that.
Ron, that's what people need to understand about pass coverage. You're not going to cover the receiver all the time. But if a receiver does get his hands on the ball, immediately you have to put him to the ground. No yards after the catch. And Jordy Nelson, we saw last week, had a ton of yards after the catch.
Third down and long again. We'll call it 10. Nebraska backs up. They only rush four. Freeman's got time. A little slip pattern. First down, Kansas State. Johnson still on his feet. Scampers out of bounds at the 39-yard line. Pickup of 19 on the play with 1:46 to play.
That's exactly what I was just talking about, Ron, in pass coverage. The coverage forces Josh Freeman to go underneath to James Johnson. But if you tackle him, boom, right there, you take a good angle, you put him on the ground. Kansas State's putting the football right now. That was one of the first times this afternoon that Nebraska's defense has taken a poor angle.
I think we saw Josh Freeman using space properly there and not trying to get the whole bundle. Here comes the blitz. Kansas State picks it up, a little fly pattern, incomplete, intended for Murphy. Nebraska brought a bunch of players on that one, including Steve Octavia, the linebacker.
Kevin Cosgrove has a good feel right now for this Kansas State offense. The defensive coordinator from Nebraska is bringing pressure, and it's effective. It's not about bringing pressure all the time, Ron. It's about when you do, you need to get in Freeman's face. And right now, Freeman is feeling that pressure.
Second and 10. Murphy wide to the right. A little shuttle pass to Patton. Oh, Lee Grosskopf would be happy except for the result. Came up with that Utah pass. No gain on the play.
Kevin Cosgrove talked to us yesterday about the one-gap responsibilities. And when you have one gap to cover, you do it. And then if you're not there to cover it, someone needs to come from the secondary and make the tackle. They've been doing neither of those things on the year thus far.
Now Freeman, this time again, he dumps it in the middle, underneath. First down, caught over the 50, down to the 48-yard line is James Johnson again. That seems to be the pattern that's working for this Kansas State offense, just that crossing pattern that Freeman's showing some patience before he throws the football.
Yeah, Nebraska's playing a two-deep zone, and they're playing it soft, which forces Kansas State to come underneath in the pass coverage.
Looks like Courtney Grigsby's getting up, and he's holding onto his arm. He's going to be escorted off the field. Check that, it's Ricky Tenars is going off the field. Stinger, maybe.
That pressure we've been seeing out of Nebraska, we need to see it again right here as Freeman's getting a feel of this game.
Inside of a minute, first and 10. Here comes the pressure. Freeman reads it, incomplete pass. Nice job by Bo Rude, and he gets the crowd to chant Rude. It was intended for Jordy Nelson.
And Bo Rude is one of those defenders that Nebraska has really missed. He's very talented, but it's his precision in carrying out the defense that's called. You can see it in his pass coverage. When a receiver is in his area, he is absolutely glued to him, and that was a good example of it on Jordy Nelson.
Well, he had the highlight of his year was a 93-yard interception for a touchdown versus Iowa State. Hasn't played since the first series of the A&M game. Second down and 10, Freeman rolling. Hit as he throws, pass to Nelson, complete. Inside the 35-yard line, down to the 33. Nelson's seventh reception, he's over 100 yards. That covered 16.
When Josh Freeman is moving to the direction Jordy Nelson is lined up, make no mistake about it, Jordy Nelson is the number one target. And you can see it on that play, Jordy Nelson going to the short corner. And Josh Freeman finds it. A great throw considering the pressure that was in Freeman's face.
44 seconds to play. Kansas State with two timeouts. Best drive since drive number two of the ballgame. Low snap, pressure. Freeman hit, dumps it, incomplete. It won't be grounding because there was a receiver there. Tier Green is the one who put the pressure on from that free safety spot.
And this is the timely pressure that I'm talking about. Tier Green, number 30, perfect timing from the secondary, comes free because he waits until the offensive linemen are engaged with somebody else, and it gives him a free path to the quarterback.
40 seconds to play in the half. Second and 10 from the 32. Freeman steps up. Jordy Nelson, normally sure-handed, could not grab onto that one. Steve Octavian was on the coverage. Let's see if Kansas State calls their timeout. They got two left with 35 seconds left. They'll be facing third down and 10. Freeman instead just looks over to the side. He's getting the signals.
And if you're Nebraska right here, you can't let number 27, Jordy Nelson, who's right here in the slot, hurt you. Look for Freeman to roll that way and try to find number 27.
It is loud. Nebraska brings the house. Freeman running for his life. He's going to go down. He throws it away. That'll be definitely grounding.
The only thing that will save him, Ron,
is a fumble.
He's outside the tackle box, but here comes the flag right here.
Tier Green again.
Remember now, outside the tackle box is only one of the qualifications. It has to go beyond
the line of scrimmage
as well, and this doesn't get there. Once again, impeccable timing by Tier Green.
That's a mistake he can't make, because that was close to being a fumble. Because you saw him bobbling the ball right there.
He actually throws it out there with his left hand.
I know. Great job by that black shirt defense again. Loss of 14 on the play.
And the significant thing is about the field goal range. That's a huge play because you don't get the play back. It's the loss of down as well.
Now, before the game, we saw Nebraska kickers kicking 60-yarders. Nobody from Kansas State tried that. And Joe Ganz, as we heard at the top of the show, telling us he wanted his team to play with fire in their belly. And in the paper earlier this week, he questioned whether some players did against Kansas.
Well, you know,
even some of the media here said these guys had no fire against the Jayhawks last week.
Well, in this team concept, and I believe football's the greatest team sport that man has ever come up with, it's amazing sometimes what ignites a team.
Mm-hmm.
And Joe Ganz has been that ignition. Right now the team is playing like that man has played ever since he was the scout team offensive player of the year clear back in 2004. It isn't like this is a new thing for that young man.
Well, he's got a lot of confidence. We talked to him yesterday. He's making only a second start. He sounded to us like he's been around a long time. Fourth down, 24 for Nebraska.
And the trips bunch up to that side is probably where Freeman wants to go, and it makes Jordy Nelson one-on-one. It's called three-by-one.
So second timeout this half.
Kevin Cosgrove came running out on the field for Nebraska. Said, timeout, guys, let's talk about this.
He wanted to see it, but that three-by-one, you get three on one side, and that's a good thing, but you also get Jordy Nelson on the other side by himself.
And as we mentioned before the game, Joe Ganz's hope was his team came out on fire.
That's what football's all about. It's just, you know, you got to play with that fire, and, you know, that it just comes from within, I think. It's just, you know, that personal drive inside, you know, that drives you out there. And it just seems that sometimes we play with a lack of emotion. You know, I hope that changes, and it should on senior day. You know, it should be, you know, emotion, you know, be riding high, especially with these seniors playing the last time on this field. You know, we should have that emotion.
Now he's trying to make it three straight for the Nebraska Cornhuskers over Kansas State. They've won 18 of the last 19. You saw the numbers on him. 28 seconds left. Fourth down, 24 for Kansas State. Here comes Nebraska again on the blitz. Freeman hit, throws, has a man, but out of bounds. Anthony West was the one who put the pressure in Freeman, spending a lot of time on the turf today.
And right now, the blitz package for Nebraska is working well. It's the timing. Guys coming out of the secondary, you have to time it well, because if you tip it to the offense, they're going to pick it up. And that time, that pressure resulted in that pass going out of bounds when Freeman actually had a receiver open downfield.
22 seconds left. Now, if you're in Nebraska, two trains of thought. You've got 22 seconds. We've got a pretty good lead here. Let's go for a couple more. Let's put a nail in the coffin.
Oh,
or
no
do you
question.
Play or do you just play a conservative?
I think you go for it. Ganz should make good decisions. You run a play if it's a good play, and then you try to finish it out. If it's not, you just run the clock out.
Well, he's looking down the middle. Pass caught inside the 25 to Todd Peterson. And he's saying, hurry up, guys. Let's get down here. 16 to play.
And he'll kill it right here. The clock stops because of the first down. And so you preserve your one timeout.
31 yards on the connection between Gans and Peterson.
And once again by Gans, he just has a feel for what he's doing. He knows where he's going with the ball. Throw a ball your receiver can make a play on, and Peterson does just that.
And he was working on Reggie Walker, the linebacker who got turned around a little bit. Peterson knew where the ball was.
And right now the decision making is at least we have a field goal attempt. So I don't want to make a mistake. If something's there, I want to get it into the end zone.
See if they throw that fade to Purify. Looking right, looking left. Has some time. 10 seconds to play. Throwing into the end zone. Caught! Touchdown, Peterson in Nebraska.
People are going to think that Jerry Tangi is back on football.
On this drive, Peterson, 2 catches, 54 yards. He gets the touchdown, only his 3rd of the year, 7th of his career. This Nebraska offense has exploded here in the first 30 minutes. Seven ticks left in the half. Nebraska smothering Kansas State, 38-10.
Look where Joe Gans starts. There's nothing there. You make a good primary decision with your feet. And when a quarterback gets outside the pocket, his receivers continue to work for him, and Peterson comes up with a big play.
And the reaction by Joe Gans, his 3rd touchdown pass. He had 4 last week against Kansas while throwing for over 400 yards, but the difference, he doesn't have a pick this day.
Wow, look at those big plays. 7 for plus 20, for 20 or more. And Joe Gans certainly has not only the fire in his belly, but he understands what his football team needs. And quite frankly, Ron, the entire state needs this kind of performance.
50 plays coming into this game, plus 20 yards for Nebraska. And you can see he's got 7 today. Nebraska's only led at halftime in 5 games this year. It has been a long time since they've led. And this is going to be the squib kick with only 8 seconds left. Kansas State will cover it up. 1 tick goes off the clock. Ron Prince's squad's going to have to do some regrouping in the locker room.
Josh Freeman has a cannon. They're on the 39-yard line. He can probably throw this with the wind at his back, certainly into the end zone. Why not? Hail Mary and see what happens. You only have 7 seconds. What's the worst thing that could happen?
Well, this Nebraska team led 10-3 at halftime versus Texas. That's the last time, but that was one of only 5 times they had an advantage in intermission.
Here's that 3-by-1 with Jordan Nelson down here by himself.
Biggest lead at halftime they had was 21-10 versus Nevada. Freeman steps up. Clock is going to run out. He is going to run out of room, and he'll go down again. This time, Barry Turner coming up with a sack. The 3rd sack for this Nebraska defense in the opening half. They only had 9 coming in the entire season. Listen to this crowd. Cheering the fact that Nebraska, riding a 5-game losing skid, has the advantage at halftime, 38-10. Here's Lewis Johnson.
All right, thanks a lot. Coach, just give us your thoughts on Joe Gans and the way he has led your offense in only his 2nd start.
Well, I think he's done a terrific job, but a lot of credit is due to our defense. And Courtney Grigsby, he had a heck of a return on the kickoff. It sparked our team, and we're just playing emotional right now.
And then how do you coach this team up to come out here and keep this up in the second half, especially
just
that pressure defense?
We just have to keep playing. That's all we need to do is try to score some more points.
All right, Coach, thanks.
Thank you.
Ron?
325 yards for Nebraska in that opening half. Joe Gans accounts for 227 of them. 3 touchdowns, including this one, closing out the scoring at halftime. Huskers up by a bunch. Since World War II, Kansas State has won only five games in Lincoln, Nebraska, including just two since 1958. And as we get set to start the second half, they find themselves down by 28 to the Huskers of Nebraska, 38-10. Well, it was Johnson, Kelly Stoffer, I'm Ron Fulin. Nebraska will get the ball to begin the second half. Rossman teeing it up. Crowd of over 84,000 on hand, hoping to see this five-game Nebraska losing streak, longest since 1958. They hope it to be broken today. This will be 5 yards deep. Nebraska will take a knee. Moments ago, Lewis Johnson talked to Ron Prince of Kansas State.
Well, Coach, on offense, your team is only averaging 3.7 yards per play, sacked three times. What's it going to take to get this offense going in the second half?
Well, we've had too many balls, plays where the defense penetrated the backfield immediately. And so it's really disrupted our any kind of continuity, made some really poor decisions. All that's behind us, and we've got to really put a good effort here in the second half, particularly here in the early in the third quarter together.
And what about slowing down Joe Gantz? He has seven passes of 20 yards or better. What's the difficulty in getting to him and slowing him down?
Well, the biggest problem is that they can run the ball right now, and then they can pass it, and they've got a lot of balance, and that's really hurting us right now. We're going to have to be able to take one of those elements away, and that's extremely hard with a player like five, but we're going to have to do it.
Thank you, Coach. Yep.
Joe Gantz comes out firing, hitting Maurice Purify again with another catch, another completion, his 12th of the ball game. Just the confidence that Joe Gans is throwing this football this afternoon, Kelly, is just remarkable.
And you see right on that last pass to Purify what Joe Gans does so well. He's a timing passer. That ball comes out on time. And that was a throw behind fade route. Throw it at the back of the receiver and let the receiver turn around and get it. And Purify with those big mitts.
Yeah, going against the wind. Nebraska, three down linemen, showing blitz, jumping all over the place. Gans has five to snap it. Kansas may have made contact. Kansas State made contact in Nebraska. See how the officials called it.
Defense, offside, five-yard penalty, still first down.
Seven penalties right now for Kansas State.
Rob Jackson is one of those defensive ends that what Kansas State likes to do is when they get ahead on down and distance in particular, they use sometimes five defensive linemen at the same time. Two defensive ends are really playing linebacker. Rob Jackson is one of them that jumps inside, covers the guard, moves out, tries to confuse the offense, and that time he just got a little bit ahead of himself.
Lucky and Lawson will go back to that two-back set. We saw a lot of in that latter stages of quarter number two. Fake to Lucky. Gans looking down the middle. Wide open, incomplete pass. Just overthrown, intended for Terrence Nunn, the senior out of Cypress Falls High School in Houston. McKinney on the coverage, but Nunn had a step on him.
One of the first times Gans has missed today. The play action pass, because as Ron Prince said, Nebraska's been so effective at running the ball. You play action, Nunn, who usually comes in motion and goes down inside and blocks, that time goes down inside and then turns it upfield and is the primary receiver.
Lucky and Lawson in the backfield. Second down and five. Look at the Lucky. Got it. Nope, lost the football. They'll call it an incomplete pass. Had it for a second, and he is down and slow to get up.
And Ron, the reason, yeah, you're right. I think it is Lucky on the ground, and that was that slip screen. It happens quickly. He gets hit inside in that offensive line. That time he bobbled it and then got hammered to the ground.
All the trainers out to check him out, make sure they're not going to move him until they find out what's wrong with him.
Ron, this third and five coming up, Nebraska hasn't been in this situation very much in the first half. They only had three third down conversions.
And we'll check on his condition when we return to Lincoln, Nebraska. Third down and five, a situation Nebraska has not faced a whole lot in this ballgame, Kelly.
Yeah, only three third down tries in the first half. They have to be successful in this situation.
On third and five, they get it easily, wide open. Over the 40-yard line to the 44-yard line is Terrence Nunn on the reception. That's Nunn's second catch of the ball game. Pickup of 12.
because of the lack of pressure up front by Kansas State, Kansas State's defensive pass coverage is being exposed. That's just way too easy on third and five. Nunn's the outside receiver, sets down in the zone, and you have Gans. It's already demonstrated that he will find the open guy. You have to have tighter coverage than that.
That's a fresh set of downs for this Nebraska offense, closing in on 350 yards already here in the ballgame. Steps up, going deep down the sideline, incomplete, intended for Lucky.
And Lucky got his wind back and came and ran an out and up, a wheel route by the running back right there. He was open once again, and Gans just barely missed him. Gans didn't miss much of those in the first half.
Already has four catches today, and he was matched up on a linebacker, John Hulick, the sophomore from Wichita, Kansas. That's a mismatch.
Yeah, and he had a step on it. The ball just was a little bit too long.
A second down and 10. They'll go from the I formation. A power running game again. Quinton Castile averaged almost 8 yards a carry in that opening 30 minutes.
He's impressive.
Oh, he is.
He's a big dude, too, at 6'1", 245. Runs a 4.5 for crying out loud. How does that happen?
That's like Jaworski laying down in A&M. He said, don't call me a fullback. I'm a 275-pound, which is probably a little bit light.
Yeah, no kidding. He's tailback. A 280-pound guard that happens to line up in the backfield of Texas A&M.
Matt Castile gives him third down and short. We'll call it three. This has been a problem for Nebraska, more than third and long this season. And straight drop. Purified. Gets by his defender. Inside the 25, close to the 20-yard line. They'll mark him down at the 19-yard line. Chris Kearney coming up from that free safety spot to save the touchdown.
Purify is matched up on Justin McKinney, arguably the cover corner for Kansas State. It's a fade stop. Purify acts like he's going on the fade, and then as the ball's coming and his back numbers, he just turns around and plucks it out of the air. Very well executed, but Gans' timing is absolutely impeccable.
Three receptions for Maurice Purify today, 65 yards. He's having an outstanding afternoon, and a fresh set of downs for Nebraska in the red zone again. Gans, plenty of time over the middle, off the hands this time of Maurice Purify. So the big banana hands have the peel taken off it.
Yeah, Purify knows he should have had that ball. Once again, Gans reading the coverage, not just going to the right guy, Ron. It's how quickly he gets to the right guy. That's the understanding of this offense.
This season, though, a lot of people on Nebraska's lineup have been able to catch footballs. 20 Huskers have at least one reception. Gans' favorite targets today have been Purify, Nunn, and Marlon Lucky. Second down, 10. All on the 19-yard line. Here comes the blitz. Gans steps up in the pocket, gets it to his favorite receiver again. Inside the 10, down to the 9-yard line. Marcus Watts on the coverage, but Purify again just split the D. And the key, though, the offensive line giving Gans a lot of time back there.
Yeah, great protection, great understanding of the offense by the quarterback, and then the receiver Purify just comes in that zone. As the inside receiver clears out, Purify has a little void in that zone. He just comes in, shows his number to the quarterback, first down inside the 10.
Nice job by Nate Swift, by the way, on that pass pattern, kind of clearing things out so Purify could get open. First and goal. Gans, plenty of time again. This is going to be an easy touchdown for Franz Hardy, his second of the ball game.
This is where you see the knowledge and talent of Bill Callahan, the play calling. Man-to-man, run crossing routes inside, and they form natural picks. And then the quarterback just picks up whichever receiver is open. And once again, Gann finds Hardy for the touchdown.
Kansas State defense only gives up 347 yards a game. Nebraska's got 400 already this afternoon. They're averaging almost 10 yards a play. Extra point is good. Earlier in the game, we showed you Jabba Chamberlain, New York Yankee fame. And, of course, the Nebraska Cornhusker getting a standing O from 84,000 and a hug from his dad. But, of course, his dad actually works at the stadium as a security guard. And Lewis is standing by with Jabba Chamberlain's pop right now. Lewis.
Yeah, Ron, we're right down in the southwest corner of the stadium in the Hewitt Center, and this is the hallway, Harlan, that you've been patrolling for a while. You've been doing this for 6 years. But first of all, back to that moment out on the field. What was it like for you as a dad to stand out there and watch your son get that honor in front of everybody?
Well, it was truly an honor for me just to be there amongst the Nebraska fans as they've embraced my son through the past several years when he played here and now as a Yankee.
And I got to ask you about this, to stand out there with your dad. He's been working here for the last several years watching you. To go from high school to pitching here to the Yankees, what's it like?
That's great, you know, to have the fans out there. And, you know, I am where I am because of they supported me and they've been here. And that's unbelievable, by the way. Wow.
And, somebody sees Harlan on TV right now, I think.
That's it. But, no, it's great to be out there with him and to know all the things that he's done for me. And it's been fun.
And what about your new manager now? Joe Girardi's in. How does that affect this next season coming up for you?
It doesn't affect anything. You know, guys are going to come out and do the things that they've done and prepare themselves. And he's been around. You know, he's been a Yankee before, and he's been a bench coach. So it's going to be good things.
And you know what? I can't help but bring up this hat. This is a unique hat. You see this? We've got the Nebraska on the left side and the New York side on the right side. Where did that come from?
It was a fan from New York or the East Coast. He called me one day and just wanted to talk. And so I talked to him, and a week, 10 days later, I get this hat in the mail.
Fantastic. Great to see you, sir, both of you. Congratulations on the honor. A pretty cool family affair down here in the southwest corner, Ron.
All right, Lewis. Actually, that was Joe Torre calling and saying, well, you want to drive and join A-Rod here in Los Angeles. James Johnson, the lone man in the backfield. He's got the football. Splits the Nebraska defense, gets up to the 40, be a yard short of the first down. Bo Rude, Armando Murillo on the stop.
That's one of the adjustments that you'd expect Kansas State to make in the second half with the passion that this black shirt defense from Nebraska played with in the first half. That's what you do. You let them come after Josh Freeman, and then you give it on the draw. You let them come after Josh Freeman. You dump screens over him, trying to slow down that pressure from Nebraska.
So you heard Ron Prince just talking about the pressure that they've seen so far in this ballgame. Just about 4 minutes gone by in the third. Pushke in motion. This time, Freeman, straight drop, pressure again. Deep out pattern caught. Inside the 45, down to the 42-yard line. Deion Murphy on the reception. That's his second catch of the game. First one only went for 7 yards.
And if you are watching the game at home, that was the far hash and a deep out to the far side of the field on an absolute frozen rope. And that's what Josh Freeman brings to the table. It's been really ineffective thus far because those Nebraska Cornhuskers have held them up in front of them, haven't allowed the big play. Freeman has to come up with them in this second half.
He's thrown 31 passes, completed 15. A little screen to Nelson. Maybe picks up one on the play. Nice job defensively. Murillo was there along with a bunch of other guys in the Nebraska black shirt defense.
Yeah, Sue and Potter and Steinkuhler. Yeah, you're right. That was great recognition. When a defensive line recognizes the screen, and that was just an outside screen, they have to turn and run because you're not going to get to the quarterback anyway. Pursue down the line, and the first thing you hit that, or you see that's on the opposite side of the field, you hit them.
Go from the I formation with Jordan Nelson wide to the right. Johnson and Pushke in the backfield. Looking for Nelson deep, going, has him, overthrown just out of the outstretched arms of Jordy Nelson. Anthony Blue on the coverage, the freshman out of Cedar Hill, Texas. That's a tough coverage for a freshman.
Yeah, that freshman was all over Jordy Nelson. And it's really nothing fancy, just runs right by him. Jordy Nelson has a step on him, and the interesting thing, the fine line we walk between failure and success in this game. Last week against Kansas, that ball is completed for a touchdown. This week it falls harmlessly to this turf.
Now Daniel Gonzalez goes wide to the right. Nelson in the slot facing third down and 9. Nebraska brings the blitz again. Freeman flush from the pocket, looking, throwing off the helmet of Nebraska. It looked like it hit Larry Asante on the top of the head. It was intended for Dion Murphy.
And Asante does a tremendous job. You're right. As Freeman breaks contain right here, he's looking downfield. He doesn't want to run the football because Octavian is going to see to it that he doesn't. But the good coverage by Asante, it hits him right in the back of the head.
The punt for the Wildcats. Oh, Nate Swift will stand at his 10-yard line awaiting the punt. Tim Rayer. It's a great guy, watch list, semifinals last year, tries to pooch this up. Looking for his 17th to stop inside the 20, and he'll be able to do that. Nice job. 32 yards on the kick, but it was effective for Ron Prince's Wildcats. They still trail, though, by a bunch. 45-10 here in the third. Field shot there. The Huskers still lead it, even from that angle, 45-10. Here's the Aflac Home versus Away Trivia Challenge. Text 1, 2, or 3 to 837787 for your chance to win a plasma TV or a trip to the Hula Bowl. The question, 11-year history of the Big 12. How many have the Wildcats and Huskers combined to win as far as the North Division titles? 6, 7, or 8? Well, we'll give you the answer coming up in just a little bit. And the last time Nebraska was backed up like this, they were able to put points on the board. Now, Gans completes up to the 15, to the 17, to the 19-yard line. Terrence Nunn on the reception. That's one of the great stories, too, because Terrence Nunn came here as a freshman. When Bill Callahan got here, he had already committed to Wisconsin. Bill Callahan told Turner Gill, we got to get this guy. He's got to come with us. Started as a true freshman.
And Nunn is that great compliment on the other side to Marcus Purify. A very good 1-2 punch that really hasn't been heard of a lot this year, but the last couple of weeks they're starting to show up as a pair.
Second down and very short. Castile hit right at the line of scrimmage. I don't think he got the first down. John Hulick coming up from that linebacker spot. They call him Little Wally because he reminds everybody of Matt Wallerstadt, who's on the coaching staff of Kansas State. Well, they're saying it's a first down.
Wow, that was a good spot. But it's also probably the first bad decision that Castile has made. And a young running back, when you only need a short amount of yardage, you have to get that first down first and foremost. You don't cut it back at a time like that.
I don't believe it, but they're actually doing the wave here. I think that's.
Why do you not believe that?
That's a 15-yard penalty. I'm sorry.
You don't like the wave?
No. It went out when I started losing my hair. Spoil sport, huh? On first down, Gann's going to run an option. Something they haven't done today. Able to pick up one, possibly two. With more on the wave, our expert of the wave. Here's Lewis Johnson.
Yes, waving expert. But listen, there's some significance here because before the game, I was outside the stadium buying a sweatshirt for one of my kids. And I asked him how sales were going. And he said, this week it's great because it's the last weekend. But in previous weeks by halftime, he said that bridge that leads from the stadium across the freeway was full of people leaving the stadium. But they're not leaving this week. They're here because of what's happening on the field. So the wave has some significance in terms of these fans. Getting what they want. Right now it looks good at 45-10 with more to play.
That's right. Gans looking over the middle. Caught. First down again. Maurice Purify. An outstanding effort again by Purify, the senior out of Eureka, California.
And it's not like it's bad coverage by Ray Cheatham, number 23. But that big body of Purify between the defender and the ball. And he just absorbs it when it gets there. That's exactly what this offense has not had consistently throughout this year.
One touchdown in each of the last four games for Purify. He's now in the top five as far as receiving yards here at Nebraska. This afternoon, 97 yards on 5 receptions. First down, and Gans wants more. Here comes the rush. He's going deep. Overthrown. Pass intended for Hardy. I tell you, they want to make sure that, okay, Kansas put 76 on us. We're going to hang something, as Barry Switzer used to say, we're going to hang a half a hundred on these guys.
Yeah, Gans certainly hasn't been bashful. When there's been an opportunity down the field, that young man is going for it.
We kind of got that sense when you and Lewis talked to him yesterday.
Why not?
Yeah.
Let it loose. See, have some fun. See what happens.
He was not tight, to say the least. Second down and 10. Gans to Lucky. Lucky, nice couple of moves. Gets over midfield down to about the 49-and-a-half-yard line. Brandon Balcom with the third stop of the afternoon for Kansas State.
It's the first time we've seen that little wrinkle in the running game. And make no mistake about it that Gans does not want to run the football. And more importantly, Callahan and Watson on the offensive play calling side, they don't want to expose Gans to big hits. Because remember, he's basically in at this point in time with Sam Keller out.
Gans, 333 yards passing today, no interceptions, four touchdowns. Third down. Just about three. 6:50 to play in the third quarter. Gans looking, throwing, another first down at the 30-yard line, out of bounds. Nate Swift with the reception, the junior out of Hutchinson, Kansas. He's over 100 receptions for his career now.
Once again, just the stop fade, and what that means is the receiver is acting like he's just going to continue to go deep. And at a certain point in time on the field, in this case, enough to yardage to pick up that first down. Out comes the ball, and then the receiver turns around and snatches it.
100 career receptions for him, number three in Nebraska history. That is best game. This is Texas a couple of weeks ago, and another first down on the 39-yard line. Another just great drive by Nebraska, and this is going to be another touchdown for France Hardy, his third of the ball game. Hardy had no touchdown receptions this year coming into this game. Four for his career. He's got three today. Gans has thrown five.
Callahan is doing a great job of not only play calling, but formationing to create favorable matchups. And then Gans is executing everything that Bill Callahan wants. Find the open guy, deliver the ball, get the ball into the end zone.
Alex Henry with the extra point.
We talked about Joe Gans finding the open guy, and this time it was Hardy. Joe Gans understands this offense. He knows where to go with the football. Doesn't have a strong arm, but he's a very accurate arm. Remember the fire in the belly? It's old hat now. Look at that. Ah, touchdown. I'm not going to waste the time running down the field.
It's been a very difficult week for that man, Bill Callahan. Rumors of him being asked to resign. He has denied that. The school denied it. Pressure because of the five-game losing streak. Future still in doubt. I think that's a realistic fact. Dr. Tom Osborne saying we're going to wait till the end of the year. But a little redemption this afternoon here in Lincoln before a sellout crowd of over 84,000. McKinney losing the handle, and he's going to take a knee. The return game has been non-existent for Kansas State today. Well, the big story is the quarterbacking of Joe Gans. Bill Callahan said he was a patient guy, knew he could do it.
To have him come in, though, under the situation and circumstances that he did last week against Kansas and play so well, just speaks volumes, not only as a player, but as a person, because that's a special quality that it takes to come off the bench on the road against the number 8 team in the country and throw up 400 yards. I just commend him in every regard and every respect. For his performance and basically for his character as a person.
He showed it yesterday to us.
Yeah, he did.
Very personable young man. Kansas State, they're in a big hole. Still over 6 minutes left in this quarter, and there's that run defense that has been less than stellar for this Kansas State team. Prior to that carry, they had only 10 yards on 17 carries. And one thing that Ron Prince told us last week is they weren't running with authority, and they really weren't running well until the second half of a ball game, and only when they were leading.
You want me to get up on my soapbox right now?
Sure.
If you want to run the ball successfully, you have to be committed to the run. And this team hasn't shown that. So you can't complain about not running the ball in situations where you want to if you're not doing it between the 20s effectively.
Jordy Nelson on the reception. It's a good point.
I mean, you have to be committed to it. That doesn't mean you're going to run the ball 10 times in a row, but the guys up front have to get a feel for it. Just like other players, the quarterback in his position has a feel for it. The guys up front get a feel for run blocking. It's an attitude. They come off the ball in a different way than pass blocking. You can't ask them to pass block 10 times in a row and then run the football effectively. It doesn't happen all that well.
First and second down on runs, they've always seemed to come up short. Here comes the blitz again on Freeman. He's able to complete the pass over the 40 up to the 42-yard line. Tuesday at 10:30 Eastern time, 10 p.m. Pacific time. The sports world has gotten a wake-up call. Five-time Emmy winner Dennis Miller is on Versus, and every week he takes an uncommon look at everything sports. From Title IX to jacked-up athletes, nothing is off limits. Plus, do you have something to say? You, too, could be a guest on the show, sort of. Got a question? Dennis wants to give you the answer. Find out more at Versus.com/AskDennis. Might be able to be on the show. Freeman looks left, throws right. Nothing doing. The black shirt defense led by Armando Murillo there to corner Deion Murphy.
And Murphy's not an easy guy to corner, and Murillo is one of those young, somewhat inexperienced defensive backs that's doing a nice job today. We saw him in on the play before. It comes up limping a little bit on that play. But that's exactly what you have to do against Kansas State. Let him catch the ball in front of you, but then come up and make the tackle. Nebraska has tackled well this afternoon.
Third down and six. Nebraska leading 52-10. Kansas State's only led a couple of times in this game. Patton. Left side looks for a block. Big guy's in front of him. Gets a couple of blocks into Nebraska territory. Marked out at the 45-yard line.
Ron, you can see Nebraska was sneaking pressure up on the right side, and that pass was that play was a quick pitch to the left. That was a perfect play for what Nebraska was running defensively.
Pick up a 15 on the play, and looking down at the Nebraska defense, Armando Murillo, two plays ago, seemed like he got the wind knocked out of him. He doesn't seem like he's altogether still on that. He's on the field.
Well, as a quarterback, you need to be aware of that, or someone needs to make you aware of that. But right now, Kansas State doesn't even have a wide receiver to his side of the field.
And the tight ends, and they're going to run the football. It's a scrum right at the 45-yard line. Zero gain.
Well, Kansas State looking to run the football a little bit right in this point in time of the game. And remember, Ron Prince is a former offensive lineman. He has that mentality. He wants his offense to have some type of running game presence, and he hasn't been happy with it. But he's the first one that will understand you have to be committed to it to be effective at it.
Freeman running for his life, throws this up for grabs. Pass is caught. What a hit, though. Deion Murphy on the reception, but Larry Asante, they call him the assassin, lowered the boom on him, but he was able to hold on.
Asante actually could have made probably a better play on the ball. The ball's in the air a long time. Asante on Murphy right there. Go for the ball at the same time you go for that big hit. Right at the other end, you can see there was an opportunity with the ball up high to come in with that right hand and just tomahawk.
Pickup of 17 on the play. First and 10 inside the 30 now for Kansas State. It is loud. Three-step drop. Freeman looks. Pass knocked away. Intended for Murphy. Penalty flag is thrown. It's going to be Amarillo. I think it was the proverbial hand on the back as he tried to reach over.
A hand on the back, maybe arrived just a little bit late on the slant to Murphy.
Pass interference. Number 5 defense. Spot foul. First down.
No, what's interesting too, Ron, is we haven't seen or heard much of Jordy Nelson in this second half. That's a good sign for Nebraska, because step number one is to take Jordy Nelson away and make Freeman go to somebody else like on this play.
Nelson had only 2 catches so far here in quarter number 3. First penalty of the second half for Nebraska. 3:02 to play in the third. 52-10. First and 10 from the 17. Puski in motion. About a little reverse. Freeman looks to throw the block. He does. This may be a touchdown. No. Nice job defensively. They closed quickly, but not before a pickup of 13 by Deion Murphy.
Kansas State will bring this out, particularly in the red zone. They like to shake it up down there a little bit. Freeman getting out in front. A nice block right there. Ron, that's a quarterback, by the way. It happens to be a 6'6", 250-pound quarterback, but you still have to have the desire. Nice play. Nice position on the field for that play.
First and goal for Kansas State. It's been a while since they threatened. How about back in the first quarter? Freeman keeps it, leans forward, he's got the touchdown. Only the second touchdown of the afternoon for Kansas State.
Ron, remember how Kansas State opened the game on that touchdown pass to Jordy Nelson? Balance during that drive. That's exactly what we saw in this drive. Balance. Freeman finishes it, but it was balance getting them down there.
Rossman for the extra point. And they'll sneak it in, that left upright. Now we've got a moment. Let's take a look at the Kawasaki Conference leaders. How about passing? You know, back in the old days of the Big 12, or Big 8, we'll go back there, 284 may have led. Now you're number three.
Yeah, it's called evolution, the evolution of the game of football. You have to put it in the air. You have to pressure defenses by the pass, spread them out, and good things happen. I mean, Texas Tech, look at those numbers. That's just outrageous.
382 yards passing for Nebraska this afternoon. Last week, Gans threw for 405 yards and four touchdowns. He's got five touchdowns. How about nine touchdowns? And almost 800 yards in 2 weeks.
Yeah, and the big difference is no mistakes.
No,
he had four interceptions last week. He's been almost flawless today.
Those are Graham Harrell numbers, aren't they? The Texas Tech.
Oh, yeah.
Ron Prince, doesn't matter what the score is. Here is part of the reality, too, for Coach Prince. I mean, he thought his team, in his words, what he told us on Wednesday, they get it. He was glad they were coming to this hostile atmosphere. He said, we've got to do that to go to the next level. But the problem is, you still have Missouri and Fresno State. Unless you pull off a miracle today, your bowl implications are riding on today and the rest of the season. This is Andre Jones on the return. Well, you take a look at the last eight possessions. Now, last week, Kansas scored on 10 consecutive possessions against this Nebraska defense, 10 touchdowns. I think Nebraska's kind of returned the favor to Kansas State.
Yeah, and what a response by this entire team. The young men, you're talking about 18 to 20-year-olds, and that represents an incredible response to the trials and tribulations this program has been experiencing. And like Joe Gans told us yesterday, and we heard on tape today, that it's about, you know, there isn't anyone that cares more about this program than the players in the program. We can't lose sight of that, and we see that today. Jordy Nelson looks like he's a little banged up. The ice pack on the right hip, and he's riding the bike. That's why we haven't heard from the young man.
Only two receptions in the second half, and with 2:42 to play in the third, Nebraska takes over. Now they're saying it's a heating pad on there. However, he's getting some treatment. Terrence Nunn on the reception. He led the team last year with 42 catches. Came into this game with 26. He's got four today, so he's got 30 on the year.
Well, the significance that it's not an ice pack versus a heating pad. A heating pad means he still wants to come back in the game. When ice starts showing up on your body, you're done.
Yeah, really. First and 10 again. 25 first downs for Nebraska in this ballgame. And we still haven't hit the fourth quarter. And steps up in the pocket, rifles it over the middle. Pass is caught by Nate Swift. Down to the 35-yard line. And again, that ball was right on the money.
We've seen that so many times today. And it doesn't really matter who's at the receiving end. This time it's Swift. Running a post route inside. The dual release kind of confuses the coverage, but the post route, and at the end of the day, that was still a very narrow window, but what an accurate, nice throw by Gans.
28 yards on the reception for Swift. Eight different receivers have caught balls today on Nebraska. Gans, this time he's got pressure. Mitchell loses the football but regains it, but it was way back at the 47-yard line. Now we're getting a little chippy. Ian Campbell, who was so outstanding last year and becoming first-team All-Big 12, had four fumble recoveries this year already, trying to get his fifth.
And Ian Campbell is in that 3-4, has moved to the outside linebacker position with Klein gone from that nose tackle. We were told he was going to play more defensive end today. That's just a quick rush inside, and it was effective, but it was the first time it was effective on the day.
It's their first sack of the day for this Kansas State defense.
Had no sacks against Iowa State last week.
Straight drop back, Gans. Incomplete, intended for Purify. A little low on the throw.
I think Purify was glad that that ball was low because the safety was fixing to peel some paint off his helmet.
I think you're right. 52-17. As you just tuned in, that is the correct score. Kansas State led 7-0. Courtney Grigsby took a kickoff back 94 yards to tie it at 10. Kansas State kicked the field goal to go up 3, and since then it's been all Nebraska. Gans on 3rd and 20. Going deep, that's going to be out of bounds, intended for Hardy, who's had a sensational afternoon.
That was nice coverage by Justin McKinney, number 22, on Hardy. Hardy was running the fade route, really a go route, but just didn't give his quarterback all that much room on that play.
Well, Nebraska is going to have to kick it away. They haven't done that since the opening drive of this football game. Oh, they're going to go for it. 4th down and 20. Nebraska, talk about confidence. 4th down and 20, and Bill Callahan is not going to call off the charges on this. And straight drop, steps up, has plenty of time. He's got running room and could get the first down, and he does. We talked about him having Chicago toughness. This is the essence of Chicago toughness right here.
It's not only 4th and 20, and he needs to pick up a first down, but watch at the end. This is Chicago tough and attitude. Don't run out of bounds. Chandler, number 21, if you want to come up and tackle me, I'll show you a little something. That's Chicago tough. A gain of 23 yards on the play.
There's going to be criticism, though, realistically. Why are you up 52-17 and go for it? Explain it to us, Kelly.
I guess I explain it with this. Why not? What do you have to lose at this point in time, Ron? I know that you understand that, but right now, Coach Callahan needs to find a way to have these players get back to the love and the fun of the game, and that's a good example of it. 4th and 20, hey, let's go for it. Now, if they're not up that big, you know, they obviously probably punted away, but right now it's about having a good time on the football field for the first time in a long time.
Now we take a look at the Big 12 North standings, and Nebraska was supposed to contend for the Big 12 North with Missouri. Gary Pinkel, this team has done a great job this year. 8-1 on the year, the only loss in the Big 12. Coming to Oklahoma, Kansas perfect at 5-0. They lead the Big 12 North. Kansas State had an outside chance of getting it, especially after they beat Texas. But as we told you, since the Texas game, they've alternated wins and losses. This time, Gans is going to be dropped at the 25-yard line by Ray Cheatham, the junior from El Dorado, Arkansas.
And another good sign for Nebraska, Ray Cheatham represents probably the fifth, maybe sixth guy coming after Gans. And remember, Kansas State is all about pressure. Pressure on defense sets the table for this entire team, not just defensively, but the entire team. The pressure numbers force takeaways, short fields, your offense benefits, but Nebraska's had none of it today.
2nd down and 12 for Nebraska. Final 30 seconds here, quarter number 3. Gans goes to the safety valve. Lucky, nice little juke move. I tell you what, that's about a decleater there.
You better break down and make a nice poor tackle on these Nebraska running backs, or they'll shake something loose on your body parts right there. Hulick just has no shot when Marlon Lucky makes the second and sometimes the third move on that play.
And that's going to be the end of the third quarter. And it was a good one for Nebraska. They led 38-10 at the end of the second. Now it's 52-17, one quarter left. The old fifth time this season, Nebraska heads to the fourth quarter with the advantage, and it's a big one, 52-17, final 15 minutes from Senior Day in Lincoln, Nebraska. It's been the Joe Gann Show. Here's Marlon Lucky. Looks to pass it, throws off the hands of Sean Hill, the intended receiver. We have a penalty flag thrown. Now, he threw a touchdown pass to Hill versus Iowa State. They tried to do it again there. And it's going to be against Nebraska, it looks like.
Yeah, hold inside. Trying to give Lucky that short
holding
corner.
59 offense, declined, fourth down.
Red Byford, the senior center.
It looks to me like Callahan's going to go for it again.
It's only fourth and two. Coming into this game, fourth down, they were 9 of 16, so they aren't afraid to gamble.
And the way that Nebraska has been running the football today, but you would think, obviously, Kansas State knows that. Maybe Nebraska wants to try to get outside right here in some form.
They're 1 for 1 today on fourth down. That was the Gans scramble. Lucky behind Gans. Brooks throws to Purify, first down, inside the 5, down to the 3-yard line. Maurice Purify, 6 catch today, he's over 100 yards.
Right now, Joe Gans and Marcus Purify, they're acting like they're in practice in a 7-on-7 drill.
Yeah.
That passing drill without a pass rush, the impeccable timing. Right there, the ball's on its way before Purify turns around to throw it right at the middle of the numbers on the back of the receiver, but it has to be great timing because the coverage hasn't been bad. Look at that, man.
School record passing yards, total yards. Joe Gans in only his second start.
He's not done yet.
No, I don't think he's coming out. And he's going to throw. He's going to scramble. Looking. Wisely just runs out of bounds. That's a heads-up play. One of the things, too, that Nebraska was telling us that about Joe Gans is he's able to take coaching. We were talking to Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator,
yeah,
yesterday. Even when things got a little hairy last week, even in the heat of battle, he was able to take coaching. Now, that doesn't sound like a lot, but as a former quarterback,
oh, yeah,
that's huge.
I totally understood what Sean was saying because in the heat of the moment, sometimes it gets quite foggy down there, and it's hard to make adjustments and learn from that. Now, you can go to the film room and learn once the bullets stop flying, so to speak, but the good players take coaching on the field and make adjustments right away.
Well, Kansas State's going to call a timeout. 14-24 to play in the ballgame. The Huskers on their way to snapping a 5-game losing streak. Nebraska threatening again, already leading 52-17. Quentin Castile now in the lineup, the true freshman out of La Porte, Texas. Had 102 yards rushing versus Oklahoma State. He's had a couple of big ones today. Three-step drop, the pump fake, thrown into the end zone, wide open. Touchdown, Nebraska. Terrence Nunn.
And Terrence Nunn is going to get the celebration penalty for spiking the football. But at this point in time, you know what? It's time to let loose. Get the dust off your back and have a good time.
Hey, Mark Rick wanted Georgia to do that a couple of weeks ago. Said, go out and celebrate, guys, and that's exactly what happened here.
And Purify runs the slant inside. Nunn starts inside and goes up and around and up outside, and he's wide open. Spike the football, have a good time. Get back to the love of the game, for crying out loud.
That's his first touchdown reception of the year for Nunn. That was a 74-yard drive, 12 plays, which has been the M.O. today for Nebraska. Long drives, not very much time. That took just under 3.5. Probably the sorest person that's going to have to take an ice bath is going to be Alex Henry. His legs got some work today. And he He's perfect on the year, has not missed a PAT. Let's check in with Lewis Johnson. Lewis.
Well, Ron, as the big plays continue for Nebraska, the playmaker for Kansas State continues to struggle with an injury. Looking at Jordy Nelson as he's working out on the bike, pedaling backwards, and he's been working it so hard that he actually broke the pedal on the left side of the bike. So it was first Nelson that was injured, now the bike. They had to retape the thing. But Jordy Nelson, with that heating pad on the right hip, we don't have any specific information. And you just got to believe that that really has been such a major problem for them offensively and trying to get something going as Nebraska fans continue to celebrate this route here.
You know it's a bad day when your exercise bike breaks on the sideline, huh?
No question. That's time to start packing it in. But Lewis is exactly right. Jordy Nelson represents that big play opportunity. And the way that this Kansas State offense currently is being efficient. And when he's not in there and he's not right, Kansas State has some clear issues.
Kansas State has been very special to the Nebraska program because back in 76, Nebraska beat Kansas State. That was the school's 500th win. In 2006, Nebraska beat Kansas State. That was the school's 800th win. And today, this score's probably going to hold up. It'll break a five-game losing skid. Because of the penalty, Kanalik is going to have to kick from his own 15-yard line. Still gets a pretty good kick away. This will be back to the 10-yard line. It's going to be bobbled by McKibben. Heads to his right, looking for some blocking. Not going to get it. Not taking advantage of the penalty and the kick. Well, the question again, in the Big 12 Conference, how many North Division titles have the Wildcats and Huskers combined to win? And the correct answer is 8, number 3.
Did you have that right?
Yes.
You did not. Look at these percentages, though.
Sam's coming up with too many hard questions. Tune in to next Saturday's Game on Versus to find out the winner. We'll get a chance to win a plasma TV and a grand prize trip to the Hula Bowl in Hawaii. January 12th, we will be there.
Those were our lowest, by far, percentages on the year.
Mm-hmm. 14:09 to play. Kansas State has the football. What does Kansas State try to prove here? I mean, you see them running the football, something they haven't done effectively, although they are better than they were at halftime. They're averaging about 2 yards a carry now. But Ron Prince, what is he looking for at this point of the game, being down by a bundle?
Well, remember, you have to keep in mind that Ron Prince is still trying to build a program at Kansas State. We're talking about year two for this new head coach. And so he wants to continue to do the things that are going to be the staples of winning football down the road. Running the football effectively is one of those staples.
Freeman getting pressure again. Getting caught from behind. He's going to be dropped at the 18-yard line. The fourth sack for this Nebraska defense. And we can't retell it enough. They had only 9 coming into this game total.
And Murillo gets there, and also Kevin Dixon, 97. Cosgrove has been waiting for this pressure to show off. It isn't like they're doing anything different today. They're just executing the defense better than they have in the past. Now, there's been some speculation or discussion of whether Cosgrove has brought enough pressure on the year. They brought pressure early against Texas, but seemed to get away from it late in the game, and it gave Texas the chance to get back into it.
4 sacks today. That's equal 40 yards in losses. Freeman, pass complete to Mastrude. He's going to be well short of the first down, and they'll face a 4th down situation. You know, we saw Kevin Cosgrove there. One of the problems these coaches, especially Kevin Cosgrove and some of the other coaches that have young kids that face this week, people have actually had other children say some sly remarks to their kids. They've taken a lot of grief from parents and kids alike here in Nebraska. Small percentage of Nebraska people do that. The rest of them have a lot more class. 37 yards on the kick. Not a whole lot on the return by Andre Jones. Well, Josh Freeman talking it over with his coach. Has not been a good day. .12:07 left to play in the ballgame. Nebraska up 59-17. A record-setting day for Joe Gans, just in his second start. He was actually part of Bill Callahan's first recruiting class. Oh, there is a deep cruncher there. John Hulick. That's a denture check, but it's still a reception.
Dan Erickson, 26, taking it on the chin to catching the football. As a quarterback, take the hit, but don't let loose of that ball.
Dan, a senior out of Omaha, part of senior day today. How about Mississippi State beating Alabama?
Oh, my.
Oh, the shine has gone off Coach Saban today.
LSU beat Alabama twice, last week and this week.
You're exactly right on that. Rest of scores from around the country. I can't believe that one. Dan still throwing, tossing away, down the middle. Purify inside the 25, down to the 20-yard line. Maurice Purify's seventh catch this afternoon. Joe Gans's dad likes what he sees.
He should like what he sees. There's no question about it. And Gans is finding the open guy, throwing it accurately, throwing it on time. You can see Gans's head started to the right side. Significant, because that's where the eyes drew the safety. And there's Mr. Gans reacting. That's my son out there getting his opportunity to play. Mike loves everything that he sees today.
488 yards throwing the football today for Joe Gans. I'm going to nominate him, Commissioner Beebe, for Big 12 Offensive Player of the Week. This time he throws it out of the flat, passes caught inside the 15. Again, it's Dan Erickson. His seventh catch of the year.
The senior on senior day.
Yeah.
Getting the rock a couple times on this drive, and that's really what I think brought the fire and the passion back to today, because Joe Gans said at the top, he said it to us yesterday, that it was about sending the seniors out with a good taste in their mouth. Guys that have sweat equity into this program, you want them to feel good about themselves as they walk out the door.
Guys did not want to be the type of player that says we're the ones that really stunk it up in 2007. Gans looking into the end zone. Touchdown, Todd Peterson. Completions of 10 plus yards for Joe Gans. 510 passing yards, 7 touchdowns for the junior from Palos Heights, Illinois, in the Chicago suburb. People at Amos Alonzo Stagg High School are cheering for this man. Point is good.
Once again, Ron, Joe Gans finding the open guy in the end zone, being patient. Watch right at the top, nothing's there. Move around a little bit, be patient, find Peterson in the back of the end zone. Joe Gans is enjoying himself today. Find those big linemen, and Mike Gans certainly likes what his son is doing on the field today.
Plenty of 30 completions by Joe Gans, 10 plus yards. 10 are for 20 plus yards. You get the sense, Kelly, that Bill Callahan has the number 76 stuck in his brain right now, and he wants to get that, but does that offset last week's 76?
That's the question of the day, and quite frankly, it's probably a question for Dr. Tom Osborne to ask.
We have shown you Mike Gans. It has been a big day for the dad, and he's standing by with Lewis Johnson. Lewis.
All right, thanks a lot, Ron. Well, Mike, how do you describe what you witnessed here today by your son?
I don't know. I'm just so proud of him. He's worked so hard, and you know, we really needed a win, and they just did a great job. The offensive line, the receivers, everybody. Just so proud of them all.
What about the way he bounced back? Think about last week, what they suffered in Kansas and having the most points dropped on them ever, but to be able to come back and lead his team the way he has today.
You know, they're just trying to get two wins. And
what is it about him that is makes him do this?
He's there for his teammates. Yeah. He wants to do good for them, and that's all. That's all.
Mike, Joe told us yesterday that he remembers you coming home from work, and he said you throw the wiffle ball to him until his hands were almost raw. What do you remember about those days, and did you see this type of ability in him at a young age?
Yeah, but I don't know. I just did everything I could, and I enjoyed it probably more than he did. I just loved doing it with him, and that was it. So, he's a great kid.
And you have a little bit of quarterbacking experience in your life also, back in Western Illinois for 1 year. What's it like to watch him maybe live out maybe at a higher degree than what you were able to do?
It's unbelievable. I don't even know what to say. I'm speechless. It's unbelievable.
And I guess finally, I've been watching all the high fives and the signals you've been getting here from the other parents, and what's it like to watch this Red Nation be excited for you as a family as your son has led the team to break this slide?
Well, you know, we've been to every home game since he's been here for 4 years supporting everybody, and now they're supporting us, and we just appreciate it. We really do. So.
All right. There's some humility there for you, Robert. He's a proud papa. Congratulations,
Thank
sir.
You very much.
All right. Well, he should be. Freeman being rushed. Has to dump it off. This is Deion Murphy. He's got some running room. Going down the sideline. Will he get Pater? No, stops short of the goal line. They'll put him at the one-yard line, but not before he scampered 66 yards.
Murphy coming on the crossing route, and even though Freeman gets pressure, he gets rid of the pressure to the right side just as Murphy is coming into his view. And then Murphy, remember, is that big play speed guy from Kansas State that we haven't heard of much today.
Ricky Tamarsh looked like he had a pretty good angle on him, but Murphy just flat out ran away. You can see over 100 yards, 5 receptions for Deion Murphy. Johnson and Pushkin now from the I formation. They fake it. Looking, throwing into the end zone. Touchdown, Kansas State. Brent Alstaff. A junior out of Hayes, Kansas. His first catch of the year, and it goes for 6.
Kansas goes to the play-action pass. The first play down deep in the red zone on the goal line. It shows the ineffectiveness in the run game, but a very well-executed play-action pass in the passing game.
Alstead, only his second career catch, by the way. First touchdown of his career. So Alstead gets his name in a book. 4 plays, 80 yards, just under a minute. Well, we have to talk about the BCS standings. Ohio State, they have obviously the game with Michigan looming, playing Wisconsin today. LSU at 8-1. Oregon, Mike Bellotti has done a great job. Dennis Dixon seems to be okay, his leg, but Mark Mangino of the Oklahoma Sooners, Missouri Tigers, all in a position if anybody ahead of them falters.
Yeah, Oklahoma's in a nice position. Kansas and Missouri are going to, one of those are going to be eliminated because they play each other in KC to end the season. So you know that one of those are going to go away.
Mm-hmm.
But the Big 12, very well represented, and there's a lot to happen. Ohio State has to go to the Big House to end the year, so anything can happen in the BCS standings before the year is done.
And of course, the Big 12 championship game, December 1st, 7 o'clock at the Alamo Dome in San Antonio. Right now, if it ended today, it'd be Kansas and Oklahoma. I think Oregon, though, they have played one of the most difficult schedules, and they've handled it quite well. Kudos to Mike Bellotti and company.
They've really gotten through the big boys already in the Pac-10, so they're in a very good position.
Since Nebraska returned a touchdown or returned a kickoff, now is Paul, the true freshman, no place to go. They'll take over with 9:57. You know, we were kidding about it a few minutes ago. Do you think that Nebraska and the coaching staff has 76? As you can see, most points ever scored by the Huskers versus Kansas State. Do you think they have 76 on their mind?
I don't know. I think there might be something slightly symbolic about that. I don't know that the 76 from last week is nullified by the 76 this week, but make no mistake about it that Bill Callahan understands the significance of demonstrating that I think he's in control. They can score points here in Lincoln. Can they defend here in Lincoln? And is he the one to take this program into the future?
Well, Bo Davis is now a quarterback, the junior from Venice, California. They don't want to play Patrick Witt, who's probably the next in line, as Lucky continues to run straight ahead. It'll be a pickup of about 10 because Witt's a true freshman out of Wiley, Texas. But they got to get Davis some kind of reps here. You can see Sean Watson over there behind Bill Callahan, but they want to give him some reps just in case, because with one game left against Colorado, you don't want to burn Witt's red shirt with one game left.
Yeah, and remember that you see Sam Keller sitting behind Joe Gans right there, but Bo Davis might be called on. Nebraska, with all the negativity that's been surrounding this program and this team, they still have an opportunity to go to a bowl game if they can win out and win their sixth game.
Now here's Lucky on first down. May have gotten back to the line of scrimmage. Well-deserved time off now for Joe Kanz. Taking over for Sam Keller, who was injured a couple of weeks ago.
And that's a great time as a player, especially a quarterback. If you've had a record-setting day, you've gotten your team off the canvas. They needed a big performance, and Joe Kanz provided that. And now he gets to sit over on the sidelines and take it all in with the teammates that his dad talked about him supporting all of his years here at the University of Nebraska.
Well, now the entire second team offensive line is in for Nebraska. Three redshirt freshmen, a junior, and only one senior. We are in Lincoln, Nebraska. It is senior day. A crowd of 84,000 have been on hand to see Nebraska wipe out that five-game losing skid. They are beating Kansas State 66-24. Along with Kelly Stauffer, Lewis Johnson, I'm Ron Thulin. Glad you're with us today. It has been the Joe Kanz Show. Joe Kanz has thrown seven touchdown passes, 510 yards for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. And what is amazing, you look at this field, nobody has left. Most stadiums, people would be booking it back now. Pass into the flat to Erickson. He's got the first down. Erickson with three catches today. Had only five coming into this afternoon. And Jabba Chamberlain giving kudos to Joe Kanz, as he should.
Jabba Chamberlain knows how to locate the fastball, and that's what Kanz has done this afternoon. Yep. He has been absolutely on target the entire day. And then you go find those big boys. That's a sign of a quarterback has an understanding. Those are the guys that get it done. Go give them a hug, a pat on the back. Let them understand that you appreciate what they did with them.
Lucky just got tripped up as he crossed the 50-yard line by Reggie Walker, where he could have taken it to Pater. Gams needs to take the big fellas down to Misty's, get a couple sides of beef down there tonight.
We did that a little bit last night. Nebraska's pep band came in, and extremely loud, by the way, but it was very, very neat to hear.
But, you know, even there, and we were kind of talking about it this morning, usually when the band comes into the restaurant, people stand up and they're cheering. Last night it was kind of subdued.
Yeah, a little subdued. It was a pretty good temperature gauge of this program right now, but I guarantee if we went there tonight, things would be happening.
Well, there's still some very difficult decisions ahead for Tom Osborne and as interim athletic director. Marlon Lucky gets the first down inside the 40, down to the 38-yard line. Gabe Cruz, the redshirt freshman out of Jonesboro, Georgia, his first tackle of the afternoon, and it's a first down again for Nebraska.
Ron, you talked to me about that Big 8, now the Big 12. What does Nebraska need to do? What are your thoughts about it? You don't necessarily have to name names, but what position is Dr. Tom Osborne in?
I think he's in a position that, number one, he's one of the smartest and most logical men I've ever met in my life. And I think he's going to make whatever decision, it will be the correct decision. I think he takes all the facts. Marlon Lucky breaks to the outside. Is he going to go? Inside the 10, down to the 8-yard line. I think that Dr. Osborne will vote to keep Marlon Lucky next year.
Yeah, I think you're right. And some of these backup offensive linemen may be around as well. And that's what it comes down to. I think the focus needs to be back on the young men on the field that are doing such a great job of continuing to fight through all this negativity. And they come out and have a performance like they did today. And Marlon Lucky really epitomized that with his tough running in the first half in particular.
Saw the numbers on Lucky this afternoon. Give it to him again. Bounces to the outside. Cuts back in. Gets to the six. And then he stood up on the play. Nebraska in the red zone today. 5 for 5. 4 touchdowns. That's 13 for their last 13 in the red zone. Lucky's had a big day. 6 catches, 78 yards, 14 rushes, 96 yards. Already had over 1,300 yards total offense. And that may be it for Mr. Lucky today. Come on, get him 100 yards rushing. Come on, he only needs 4. Closing in on 5.5 to play. Second down and goal. a steal inside the 5-yard line.
And it's interesting because that's what you see with Marlon Lucky not in there. Quick Castile comes in and isn't quite as patient as Lucky is. Mm-hmm. That was a play that you needed to be patient. Nebraska was pulling an offensive lineman from the left side to be the lead blocker. Castile just got a little bit ahead of himself.
I'll put it on the 3-yard line, third down and goal from the 3. Castile with Lawson in front of him. Inside of 5 minutes to play. Castile takes the hit, gets back to the line of scrimmage. Marcus Perry, 3 stops for the senior from Leawood, Kansas. Now you think they'll kick? I think they're going to go for it.
I don't think there's any question about it. And certainly the 84,000+ here dressed in red want the same thing. And I guarantee you about 84,000 of them are thinking of 76 as well. I don't know that Coach Callahan is, but the rest of the people in this stadium are.
This could make the postgame handshake interesting. Marlon Lucky comes back in, by the way.
Yeah, it depends on what you do here, but Marlon Lucky comes back in. Look for him to be figured into the play in some form.
Fourth down and goal from the 3-yard line. Lucky. Touchdown, Marlon Lucky.
Nebraska shouldn't hear a complaint out of Kansas State. You can't get much more basic than that. It was a zone running play to the left side, a hat on a hat, and the guy that got him here today gets the ball into the end zone.
700 yards total offense, over 700 for Nebraska. Again, this is a Kansas State team that gave up 347. You've doubled it. I think there was a lot of pent-up frustration
built
up here. Yeah. 73-24. Marlon Lucky, what a day. 2 rushing touchdowns, a receiving touchdown. He's over 100 yards running and over 75 yards receiving.
Lewis Johnson back in Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska. And there you're looking at Joe Gans, who has led his team to what looks like the end of a 5-game losing streak. And just a few moments ago, there's a shot of his dad, Mike, coming down out of the stands for a hug, a moment that they will always remember. But look, watch this now. Oh, well, I've got a second. Sure, I'll sign that autograph, little guy. And there's a pat on the shoulder for a quarterback who has really taken this team on his shoulders and has lifted this crowd of 84,000 back to believing that Nebraska football will be all right under the direction of Joe Gans. That's pretty cool stuff, guys.
Yeah. I tell you what, when the funny part was, his dad couldn't come to one of the games because he had to watch the dogs back in Chicago. And we asked Joe, who's watching the dogs? He said he thinks his sister is this week. So, sister, hopefully your brother has entertained you this afternoon. Well, you talk about smooth. Joe Gans has been smooth. Our always smooth moment of the game presented by Keystone Light. This was his first touchdown. Now watch this. Oh, my. I'm all excited, right? Well, the guy has thrown 7 touchdowns, and as he keeps going, the reaction gets less and less till it's the point. Yeah, okay, that was good.
And then whatever.
Just another one.
Go find an offensive lineman to jump on.
Our Keystone Light always smooth moment of the game.
He got increasingly smooth as he threw. Yeah, well, you know, when you have 7 times to try it, it gets old hat.
Well, you have to go back to 1995 versus Iowa State, the last time Nebraska had 700-plus yards. And against those same Cyclones in 97, the last time Nebraska scored 70 points on an opponent. A lot of history here today, a lot of record-breaking. Not for K-State. They've got to regroup, though.
Yeah. We saw them last week against Iowa State, and Iowa State just kind of kept them off balance the entire time. No pressure from the Kansas State defense that's known for pressure. And you talk about Kansas State's winning ways, the way that Ron Prince wants to win. Win on special teams, have a decided advantage, negative. Have defensive pressure, didn't happen. Play a clean game, penalty-wise, they had quite a few penalties that hurt them today.
Well, they had 7 total for 40 yards, but here's the problem. You still need a game to become bowl eligible. Now, that doesn't guarantee you're going to a bowl. In fact, only the Independence Bowl was here today to watch these two teams play, and that's got to be a first in Nebraska history. But you still have to play Missouri if you're Kansas State at home next week. Missouri battling, of course, for the Big 12 North. Then you have a non-conference game on the 24th against Fresno State. Pat Hill's squad always difficult to play at Fresno State.
Well, and if you end up, both teams could end up with six wins, which qualifies them, but after this shellacking, what is a bowl going to do? Nebraska travels very well, so I think Kansas State needs to win a couple more games.
I think they do, too. Johnson had to slip and fall as we close in on 3 minutes to play in this ball game. I'll tell you what, though, talking to Ron Prince the last 2 weeks, this man is going to do an outstanding job at Kansas State. As you mentioned a while back, he's building a program. It's his first head coaching job. Worked with Al Groh at Virginia, who's also having a great year. He understands what it takes. Right now, this team doesn't have any stars. They're just a group of kids that play hard every game. Maybe they need one or two more stars. Jordy Nelson, I would consider a star. He, of course, as Lewis talked about, hasn't played a lot here in the second half, only two receptions.
But that's a great point. When Jordy Nelson could not play, what happened? Josh Freeman wasn't real comfortable, really, with anyone else. I think Freeman certainly has the ability to be a star. Jordy Nelson is going to be gone after this season. So you're right. They have to surround Freeman with some playmakers.
Catch is by Tony Purvis. Sticking with running the football. It is Johnson going inside the 20, and he is going to score. Just slips in. James Johnson, the touchdown for Kansas State. 53 yards with 2:19 to play.
And that is what the Nebraska faithful has seen today. Guys out of position at the first level and then missed tackles at the second level. And 53 yards later, Johnson is standing in the end zone. It was kind of deja vu all over again for Nebraska fans. And then they looked up at the scoreboard and said, oh, you know what? We can take a deep breath.
Well, you know, it's funny. They only had 55 yards rushing, Kansas State did, coming into that 53-yard touchdown run. So you're going to look at the stats tomorrow and say, oh, 108-yard rushing, that's not bad. Well, they had 1 yard at halftime. Extra points good, 2:19 to play. Ron Prince's squad still playing, 73-31. Well, of course, when you talk Nebraska football, you talk Bob Devaney. You talk Tom Osborne, the hand-picked successor for Bob Devaney. 1994, how about a national championship? 3 out of his last 4 years, he directed a national championship. Nebraska beating Miami. What an outstanding black shirt defense. And he doesn't even flinch when he gets the Gatorade poured on him. And then in 1995, they do it again. Another national title. 1997 against Tennessee. Behind Scott Frost, he lifts the trophy again, goes on to serve in Congress, and of course replaced by Frank Solich, who was then replaced by Bill Callahan. And the question is, will be here next year.
Well, certainly Tom Osborne's going to have everything to say about that, evaluating the program as we speak, but Nebraska just wants to see good football. And they just know they haven't seen it this year.
I agree. Kick off up over the 30 to the 33-yard line. Andre Jones, cornerback, who's got a lot of kickoff duty. Well, the NHL versus Monday, we're in the Eastern Conference, where the Southeast Division leading Carolina Hurricanes take on the Florida Panthers. Then on Tuesday, we head to the Western Conference, where the Central Division leading Detroit Red Wings take on the St. Louis Blues. Division collisions. It's the NHL on versus Monday and Tuesday night.
Division collisions, huh?
Okay.
There's a lot of collisions in that sport.
I see so. 2:10 to play. The next versus game for this crew will be December 1st. Cal Stanford, Ted Robinson, Christopher, Lewis Johnson will be on hand for that. Then on January 12th, we all go to the Hula Bowl. Davis still in at quarterback. Quentin Castile getting the call. 73-31, Nebraska with one game remaining on their schedule, and it's going to be a tough one. It's 2 weeks from yesterday. On the 23rd, they have to play at Colorado. Usually that is a game that might mean something, and It will for Bill Callahan. Will they get a chance to be bowl eligible? And Dan Hawkins' squad, I tell you, Cody Hawkins has done a nice job for the Buffaloes this year. Good football team. He's going to be ready for Nebraska, but at least this team has a week to enjoy what they've done today. .125 to play. Matt Senske now in at fullback, putting Castile there, and they're going to take a knee and just let this thing run out. The fans want more.
Yeah. The fans always want more, by the way. But it was the right thing to do.
Yes, it was. Well, Bill Callahan, it's been a tough week. Did not want to talk about what has happened this week to us yesterday. His team has come out and played hard. He said, all I'm going to do is keep on coaching hard. We're going to push these kids, just see if we can turn this thing around. And because of that young man's tenacity, this Nebraska offense has been explosive today. Another running play, and that is probably going to do it. Castile on the carry. So Nebraska over 700 yards total offense. Gams, 510 of it, 7 touchdowns, no interceptions, no turnovers in the ball game. The first game this year that Nebraska has not had a turnover. We'll be back to wrap things up from Lincoln, Nebraska right after this. Stay with us.
Introducing the all-new Nissan Rogue. With our intuitive all-wheel drive system that reacts to the road in a tenth of a second. And a fuel-efficient 27 miles per gallon. It's a whole new crossover from Nissan. The all-new Nissan Rogue. Game on.
Enter a world beyond sight. Enter a world beyond sight. Introducing the revolutionary Kuro.
Big 12 Football on Versus is brought to you by Jack Link's Beef Jerky, Feed Your Wild Side, and by TomTom. To learn more, visit TomTom.com.
Nebraska 5-6 on the year, 2-5 in conference play. Kansas State 5-5. They drop to 3-4 in conference play. Let's go down to Lewis Johnson with our star of the game.
All right, thanks a lot. I've got Joe Gans down here celebrating with his team. Joe, what does it mean to you to have led your team to this win, stopping the 5-game losing streak on Senior Day?
It means everything, you know. I mean, I just wanted to go out there and play as hard as I could for these seniors and, you know, leave everything on the field for these guys because they've earned it. You know, I wanted to send them out right, and I did.
You talked about that fire in the belly, really competing. Did you see that? Did you feel that today?
Yeah, I mean, it was a total different atmosphere today. It was unbelievable. You know, the seniors came out with great intensity. The crowd was great, and, you know, you just can't say enough about these guys.
And Joe, we talked to your dad during the game. He was so proud, he was almost speechless. We saw the hug. What does it mean to kind of live a boy's dream to come here and lead his team to a victory in a big game?
It's awesome. You know, it's a dream come true. I've been a Nebraska fan my whole life, you know, even growing up in Chicago. I mean, it's a dream come true just to, you know, come on here and honor the former players that have played here and just put up a performance like this. You know, it means the world to me.
And finally, was this an example of Chicago tough?
I guess so.
All right, Joe Gans, right, Chicago tough today, Ron.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Final thoughts, Kelly.
Well, if you are patient, good things happen. And Joe Gans was the perfect player at that position for this program today. He was exactly what Nebraska Cornhusker Nation needed to get back on track.
It was a happy senior day here in Lincoln, Nebraska. Nebraska losing last week to Kansas, come back and beat Kansas State today 73-31. Coming up next, the 2007 Sony Ericsson Championship. For Kelly Stauffer, Lewis Johnson, and our entire Versus crew, I'm Ron Thulin. Thanks so much for watching. Have a great afternoon, everybody.